Mandem.
That's good.
How long? Actually, let's do it properly.
We're back, pussy!
No, wait. I even forgot what man used to say, yeah? What the man used to say? The Rock, he said back in the day?
Finally!
Yes! Let's go, man. The real laugh again.
Finally!
The Rock has come back!
Home.
Trust.
Mandem. It's been a long time coming, man. Like, you know, we haven't recorded in a studio in time. How you man feeling?
Feeling good, man. Alive, awake, full healthy, well.
Put that Eric Bischoff.
Fam. So basically, because of COVID and stuff, we haven't managed to film in the studio. But we've been doing stuff on Zoom. I know guys are bored of the Zoom stuff. Like, obviously the Zoom, there's so much you can watch or someone being on the webcam. Feels like you're watching Babe Station after a while. But it's only right that we came back into the studio and
this guy knows something that we don't know.
Hey, relax, please. Please. You know, them cam girls and that, fam. You got what I mean, fam? Not so calm, man. Like,
hey, can you turn around, please?
But yeah, we're back. Like, it's been a long time coming, I'd say. I kind of missed it, man. It feels good to actually be here in the flesh with you, man. Like, you know, obviously I've seen Derek a few times. Over this whole COVID period, but as the rest of the man, I haven't actually seen you. And bruv, the man himself, bruv, Mr. WrestleManiac,
he's left the room.
Bro, he's left the room, fam. There's no blanket behind him, fam. There's no blanket behind my man, fam.
Different setup,
fam. Listen, yeah. Sorry, but yeah, I let man. You know, let's do it properly, man. Let's introduce ourselves, man, and. Yeah, man, let's do it properly.
If you don't know what you're watching the Wrestling's podcast, by the man and for the man, them.
Yo, oh, wait. Is that your intro now?
No, it's just
Oh, that's your thing. Oh,
always man, them. Yeah, always that for Wrestling.
I thought we'll do a new thing because we're in the studio now. Like.
No, we're going to get back to normal. Go on,
Laps. It's your debut, bro. It's your debut. And this, I can't lie, you're not in the canteen no more. You got to come out. You know what I mean, fam? Trust me, fam.
You know what? I'm going to do something different. I'm going to come up on the spot with my promo, okay?
Jeez.
Because, you know, experts out here.
Man says he's AEW. Come on. No script.
No script. So it's your boy, the Laps, straight out of the canteen. Listen. Straight out of the canteen, still a kitchen king.
Jeez.
I want to fight The Rock. Okay. Vince McMahon, you going to book it?
Right.
Either yes or you're not.
Okay.
Right.
You know, it's your boy, the Laps here on Rest Things. Dunno.
Marco.
Bars.
Oh, I'm finished. When I say Guap, you say Daddy. Guap.
Daddy.
Guap.
Daddy.
Strong star rating. Leg drop hating. Oh. Big back rubbing. Chris Jericho loving. Son of a gun. It's your boy. The old boy here.
Oh my God.
Fam, I feel like I've gone like left with my intros now, man. I'm bare like formal with it, bro. Calm, what the hell? But yeah, man, it's the VHS Pappy here. You can holler me on my phone line for any VHS cassettes you need. I got WrestleMania, I got No Mercy, I got Survivor Series, I got SummerSlam, I got Vengeance, I got In Your House, I got what else is there, man? Come on, gas me up, what is it?
WWF,
I got AFW, Bruno Sammartino, them man, I got Iron Sheik in them man,
I got Carl Gotch
in them man, I got Big Daddy K, what's the guy called again? The Big Daddy guy?
Big Daddy V.
I'm provoked. That wasn't for me, by the way, bro. I've got every single cassette that you want.
Hit me up, man.
I'm excited to be back, Mandem. And yeah, I want to pass the mic on to you. The man himself.
Yes.
The myth.
Have you got a promo already, bro?
The legend.
I just had my regular intro. My name is Mex. I'm a wrestling fan, wrestling enthusiast, a WrestleManiac, if you will.
What?
And today, I'm on the Rest Things podcast.
Reload it, no, start again. We have to reload it.
Don DeMarco.
My name is Mex. I'm a wrestling fan, a wrestling enthusiast, a WrestleManiac, if you will. And today, I'm on the Rest Things podcast.
Big up.
Come on. As you lot know, Sam Blacks, Mr. Controversial, Underdone.
Big Daddy B.
Damn, I'm coming for you. See this podcast episode? No, I'm coming for this bastard. Bastard. Very hot place for him. Trust me. Say no more. It's all right. It's all right. Anyway. Viscera top five dead or alive. Underdone. You know what it is. By the way, with the Viscera top five dead or alive, please. Like, it's you know.
Is it Bantz?
Like, it's Bantz.
He's serious. Yeah, are you not serious?
I'm not serious.
Oh, that's it then.
Really?
Hey, let's go clap.
This was not in my top 10 wrestlers.
No, I don't know if he's top five big men.
Yeah, he is. No, okay, you're serious about that then?
Yeah.
You're still in there. You're still in there.
I thought
you changed your mind, fam. I thought you were born again, fam. Hey, Mandem.
Where do we start?
First thing, let's start with AEW first. Did you guys watch the pay-per-view?
Yeah.
Did you man enjoy it?
I watched a bit of it still.
You already know that me and AEW.
If I'm honest with you, I have not been invested in AEW since Moxley's comeback. And I feel like that pay-per-view on Saturday really like cemented it for me. I didn't enjoy no match on that pay-per-view. And I won't even be one of these wrestling fans that just like to complain about everything, because you know me, I don't like to complain about everything. I always find something good about a wrestling product. And this one here, well, I watched it and I was like, bro, like, this is boring, fam. I'll pass the mic on to you.
I think it was a bit underwhelming in some places, especially where All Out is supposed to be their WrestleMania equivalent.
What?
Wait, what? Yeah. Is that what we're doing? Wait.
All Out.
I thought Double or Nothing was the WrestleMania equivalent.
That's what I thought.
It's All Out.
All Out, that was the WrestleMania equivalent?
Wasn't it? I feel like I'm buzzing.
No, I thought it was meant to be Double or Nothing, but it's actually All Out is like their big show of the year. So on that sense, of course, it was underwhelming. And then I think a couple of things just didn't click. A couple of things they tried didn't click. A couple matches. We had Big Swole versus Britt Baker in what was like some cinematic comedy match.
Bro, that match there, yeah. I'm sorry to say, like, big up the women involved. You guys really, you know, you're carrying moments in it. But I thought that match was dead as well, fam. That match was trash. I'm sorry, man. Like, brother, am I being one of these wrestling fans here? Am I being honest?
You're being honest, man.
What do you think, bro? You're sitting there looking at everyone's face. What do you think?
I mean, I agree with Mex. It was very underwhelming. I don't I've seen a few people say that. As a whole, it was trash. Like, there was no good matches, which I definitely disagree with. There were a few moments there. I feel like the Sheeta versus Thunder Rosa match, for me, was probably the best match of the night.
Yeah, but they had to use someone from NWA. Anyway, that's fine.
But, I mean, the women's division there is already thin, you know what I'm saying? But, I mean, for me, I felt like that match should have been a bigger deal. Like, this is NWA and AEW coming together. You know what I'm saying? Like, even if they had, like, a few wrestlers from NWA just coming to support and maybe planting seeds for... I know Nafi loves Invasion, like, you know, I'm not saying
just to let
people know that, rah, like, you've got them from the NWA coming over to our side, you know what I'm saying? I thought like the match had more of a build. It was only like a 2-3 week build, but it was a good match. For me, another match that I enjoyed was, funny enough, on the buy-in was Private Party versus Dark Order, which was a good match. I think... As time went on for the pay-per-view, what kind of dampened my mood was the whole Matt Hardy situation. I felt like the pay-per-view already for me was getting a bit...
What happened with Matt Hardy?
Oh, can we talk? Yeah, sorry.
Yo, just to interrupt quickly, yeah. The Battle Royale was good. Forgot to mention that. I was good.
That was one of the worst matches.
I mean, as in the whole, the actual action in that match. I thought it was good.
That match was shit.
Where was the first one?
That was one of the worst matches.
The battle was good. Actually, it was even a battle that I liked. There was one match in there which I actually enjoyed watching. Let's say the matches, please.
Let me go through.
Sorry, go through the matches, please.
So I'll forget the buy-in stuff. So there was the Young Bucks versus Jurassic Express, which is a decent match. Lance Archer won the, what's it called? Battle Royale. Mark Hardy beat Sammy
Guevara. No. Sorry, it's the wrong thing I watched then. Sorry. It wasn't that.
I was thinking about a different paper.
I think it was an actual AEW live show on a Wednesday that I saw.
Yeah.
Sorry, don't mind me.
Like, even the Dark Order versus Matt Cardona, Scorpio Sky, and Natural Nightmares. I thought like that was just like a dynamite match. Like, it didn't need to be on the paper.
You see what I mean when I said...
I would prefer at least Brody Lee having a match or just defending his title against someone. It could have been anyone. We know it would have been a squash.
we would have enjoyed it the same way. You know what I'm saying?
You see what I mean when I said that? Like, no offense to AW, but I feel like everything feels like a pay per view. So when you're watching the actual pay per views, you can't differentiate on what's good. Nothing feels like, I'm not even being deep to these, man. Obviously, they're doing their thing and that, but nothing actually feels as special.
I'm definitely being deep to these lot. These lot said they were the freaking, they're going to be the next thing. The way they've bragged, in it, getting everyone on Neville, on planes and stuff like this, trying to overgas the thing like it's football transfers. Like, do you see where I'm coming from?
Yeah.
Like, he looked overed it. Like, he didn't need to over it. He should have just calmed down, said the levels, like, we're coming, like, what's up for us? Don't say you're the next big thing, because you won't. You can't beat WWE. I told you, McDonald's.
But my thing in terms of like action and whatnot, this was possibly like their worst show. 100. But WWE have been having bad shows.
But you know what I've been hearing in the podcast? Okay, fair enough. That I've heard there's been positives about AEW. It hasn't really been that much positive.
No, don't get me wrong. Really, there's a lot of things I hate about AEW. Mm-hmm. I could talk about it all day. But if we're talking about the positives, there is a lot of positives. Whereas with WWE, I feel like there's more negatives than there are positives with the way they book art, the way they book people. Most of the men are chilling in canteen. Don't get me wrong, AEW have that similar kind of thing as well. Yeah. There's a lot of promises AEW made us from the get-go. Even till now, I'm thinking, fam, like, it reminds, I don't even have to explain it, but there's a lot of things that AEW promised us, and in my head I'm thinking, none of this has come to pass. When it comes to like them having too many factions, they're putting so many different people in factions and tag teams. For me, it's like, why don't we just establish the main eventers, the mid-carders, and then whatever comedy act you want to do, or, you know what I'm saying?
That makes sense. Do that
another time. But for me, it's like, yeah, AEW, we have a lot to scream about, but the positives have been, week in, week out, they've been giving us good shows, despite having a few blunders here and there. It's just the Matt Hardy thing has rubbed me the wrong way.
I think, well, get onto the Hardy thing in a second, because we can't not talk about that.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
the pay-per-view thing that we're discussing, I think is the issue, and WWE do this too, is they believe a pay-per-view is where everyone should get a paycheck. So they put everyone, every match, every feud on the card where it's not really that. So that ultimately waters down what a pay-per-view should be. It should be the culmination of the biggest matches happening over whatever, the 3-month, 4-month period. But yeah, like you're saying, when they put the Dark Order tag team match on there, like, that's a dynamite match. But maybe for them, maybe it's being good employers, they want to give everyone a big payday, I don't know. But obviously for us watching, it isn't the most interesting thing to see. Like, you want to see banger after banger, like it's a pay-per-view.
I'm not gonna lie, with AEW I see a lot of repeat matches on Dynamite on their main pay-per-view stages, and it's just like watching normal TV. It doesn't really feel special, you know what I'm saying? So I feel like that's the repeat thing that I keep on
and
seeing.
And I thought that's the problem with AEW. They tried too much.
But credit,
the moveset, everything.
What I do agree with is that there's no real balance between like what you expect from a Dynamite match to what you expect from an AEW pay-per-view match.
That's my
with
problem.
With like WWE, they all kind of limit you with the kind of stuff that you're allowed to do
and
within the match.
And that's because they've been trained in terms of the performance center, in terms of even like, you see some superstars go back.
But then again, that's even due to WWE's longer schedule with them being on the road like 300 days in the year, you know what I'm saying? So they have to kind of lessen the amount of type of moves that they do, so that way they can be sustainable for the year. Whereas with AEW, besides maybe the other indie shows that they're doing, they're only there filming once, or they're probably filming there once a week, you know what I'm saying? And with them, it's like you're having high octane match at Dynamite, then having a high, even high octane match, and it's like there's no real slowdown. Like for me, that's why even when people talk about their favorite tag teams and the Young Bucks, for me it's like I like the Young Bucks, but for me, once you've seen one Young Buck match, you've seen every single one. You know that someone's gonna do a super kick spot, they're gonna miss, and they're gonna hit Nick with the, they're gonna hit Nick. You know, like, you know exactly how you can, fam. If me and you were a tag team and we're gonna go against the Young Bucks, I know exactly what moves they're gonna do. I'll just say to you, bro, listen, what you're gonna have to do is just stay on the floor.
Can end the show is coming.
Nick is gonna do X Factor, he's gonna now do Moonsault, and then he's gonna go, you know what I'm saying? So there's no real differentiation between, like, let's say for example, like Seth Rollins can put on a good 10-minute match on Raw. But the minute you see him on a pay-per-view, maybe he's doing a big match against like John Cena or Brock Lesnar, you know this is where he's going to now start doing Phoenix splashes. He's going to start doing front flip. You know what I'm saying? That's the thing.
WrestleMania.
That's why when people complain about the style and saying that there's no difference, I understand it. because really and truly.
So you understand when I said that from time ago?
No, no, I said to you, okay, I agree. Cool. But then, I mean, I don't know. I enjoy that style, but it's like when you're watching it every single week, and then you're now going onto a pay per view, and the pay per view's meaty.
Do you know why that is? It's because you're getting so much high octane matches and they're like doing all their movesets. When it comes to the main stages, you're looking for something new, but you've already seen it constantly every single week that, oh, he's done a Canadian Destroyer, done a super kick, done a 450 moonsault or something like that. Now you're looking for something new, but you're just seeing the same thing over and over again.
And then that's what opens up the door for the likes of Matt Hardy, as old as he is, to be going up a scissors lift and getting speared from about 12, 15 feet high.
Oh,
because
wow.
they've done everything that they should be doing on TV, or maybe they should tone it down on TV. There's nothing left. We have to give them something special at the pay-per-view. And now man's got a concussion and continuing wrestling matches.
Oh, wow. That's fucking ridiculous.
I think maybe in their defense, what it could be a thing with, they don't really have that many pay-per-views, so they're trying to create as many moments
but
on TV. But at the same time, we don't, like, you can have the moments here and there. Like, we had moments back in the day, like Stone Cold coming in on Raw and spraying people with the beer can.
Yeah.
I'm with the beer truck. You know what I'm saying? You can have those certain moments on your show, but it's not every Dynamite we need to have moments. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I'm all right with seeing someone like Pete Avalon, that's a jobber, just come and do comedy spots sometimes. I don't mind that. I don't have to see Canadian Destroyer from match 1 to 7. Like, it's dead.
Did you see? Okay.
It's dead, man.
Let's go back on that whole Matt Hardy concussions episode. Fam, when you watched that, like, didn't you not get goosebumps, fam? Man was like,
I did. I saw
his eyes roll back.
I don't even have any idea.
His face
about
was blue. His face was blue. And I was
So obviously, that wasn't meant to happen, right? Obviously, So
they went too far.
They were based on the crane, right? And the crane was going up. It stopped there, and after Matt, Sammy Guevara speared Matt off the table. But the way the crane was positioned, it was like there was no space in between the table. There wasn't enough space between the table and the crane. Mm. So obviously he speared him, and his head's hit the concrete rather than hitting through the table. Because if it hit through the table, it would have been a bit more safe. Mm. Do you know what I mean? So he's
kind of a,
if this was the crane where they were here, the tables are here, my lap. They overshot.
Yeah. So he's over speared him. No, so once he's fell on the floor, he's like, Matt's just gone. Like he's, like I've never seen Matt like that before. He looked like a vegetable. Like he was just like that.
And bearing in mind, he's fallen through how many tables in his career?
Do you get what I mean?
Like, this is nothing new.
We've seen Matt do the maddest stuff in WWE, fam.
100%.
And anywhere else, like we've seen him do the maddest stuff, falling through tables, all that sort of shit. But this one here, I was like, bro, is this guy all right? Like, he was completely, like, vegetable, bro. And it was sad to see, man. And, like, the match continued, and I was like, wait.
What do you mean?
The match continued?
What do you mean the match continued? If you say man's a vegetable, how did the match continue?
He got it. So they stopped it.
The referee threw up the X.
The referee done this.
The referee threw up the X to end the match. I don't think Sammy Guevara quite got the picture. Yeah, he got up and tried to pick up Matt Hardy. Matt Hardy couldn't stand.
Bro,
he was
sorry.
Oh, that's an experience.
Bro, no. Matt Hardy couldn't. Bro, it was so sad. He couldn't stand. Bro, he was falling out. He was falling over.
Fram. Obviously, he's heavier than Sammy Guevara. So Sammy Guevara was struggling to keep him up. Some like other kind of paramedics or officials came in and tried to separate them and kind of tell Sammy, this is a real thing. This isn't, you know, part of the story. Referee threw up the X again. Sammy Guevara walked off. They ushered him off. Matt Hardy then kind of got back into character and was like, I'm not finished with you, blah, blah, blah. All his broken stuff. Mm. Apparently, there was like a 67 second break in between where they put the camera, I think, on the commentators, and they were kind of buying time effectively, saying what's going on and all this kind of stuff, that the match has to be called off. Sammy Guevara had made his way back to the ring area. 67 seconds, they have now come out and said they conducted a concussion test.
Oh.
Where in this concussion test, they look at your eyes, the dilation of your eyes, then they ask you some questions and to basically find out if you're all right. Matt Hardy passed, and then he just ushered him back to the ring.
Man graduated. He passed. Distinction. Fam, the guy was completely vegetable, bro.
No,
for him to start, that was mad. That shit that you've seen happen in like WWE, like in 1990.
Attitude
God knows
error.
Attitude error. Like, God bless his soul, Owen Hart fam. Like, do you get what I mean? Man. That stuff you see there. Literally, do you get what I mean? Like, again, that stuff can't run no more. In 2020, fam, if you see someone looking like they're about to die on TV, done it. Cut it off, bro. Mm. Like, come on. Like, it's done.
Hi, this is the Superior Cypriot Theodoros, and you are listening to the Wrestling's podcast.
That's ridiculous.
I thought sad for his wife as well. His wife was proper like messaging, like writing stuff on Twitter, and I was like, fam, I feel your pain, fam.
But she does have a tendency to be jarring. Like.
She does. I've seen her stuff. She's different.
She got Twitter fingers.
She's got Twitter fingers.
She needs to, like, I get it, but sometimes just relax.
But on this occasion, I'm with her, man.
Yeah, 100%.
But I'm hearing that he didn't even have a concussion. I'm hearing so many different stories. She's saying that they did. Tony Khan is now saying, oh yeah, he's come back from the hospital. There's been no concussion, so it's like,
you don't know who to believe in this situation, right?
I don't know, man.
Obviously, she's saying that anyone with eyes can see that he was concussed. They said they'd done a concussion test and he passed. So I guess he may not have had an actual concussion. They've done the testing and he's fine, whatever. But when he hit the ground, we all saw what he looked
vegetable.
Like. When he stood up and tried to stand on his 2 feet, he couldn't. So if it wasn't a concussion, I don't know what's under that on the spectrum, but man had something.
Madness.
100%. And then
from when he couldn't get up, like jump, like actually get up, like as you know, normally, bro, there was something wrong there, fam. Do you get what I mean?
That's something wrong.
Wow, that's shocking to hear still.
For AEW, I mean, the high spots are cool, but like they need to chill a bit with it, you know what I'm saying? Because that one was like Matt Hardy at his age as well. Like, I don't think he should be doing high spots like that, you know.
I think what's even more irresponsible was obviously when he got back up and he got him back into the ring area, they obviously went straight to the finish of the match, which was him and Sammy climbing up this other 15-foot structure. This is a man that may not have just had a concussion. You just allowed him to climb up something. And I'm not no like WWE stan or something, but I know if this was WWE, they would have been washed. They would have, like, if WWE allowed this to run, they would literally be in so much trouble right now.
Yeah, 100%.
But I don't know.
Like I told you, McDonald's.
Man, it's fair to say AEW, like, obviously they showed up. They obviously gave us all out. I wasn't happy with it. I want to just include this new feature on, like, a new segment on our show where we actually rate the show. So out of five, what are you man saying for AEW? Like?
People start.
Because fam, it's not every day. It's not every day Dave Meltzer and them, man. Some days referees come to referee for rating, fam. Fam, what the hell, bro?
They're going nuts. I'm gonna have to say NA because I didn't fully watch the pay per view. I only saw the Matt Hardy
and as well, bro.
Sammy Guevara incident. So I need to go back and watch it, and then I'll be able to give you a proper rating. But right now, I can't really give anything right now.
There was a few entertaining matches. Majority of it was shit. But I'll give it a 2 out of 5.
Mad.
I love Del, man. He's so real with it.
I'm gonna be in the same. 2 out of 5. I'm gonna be in the same boat as Laps. I didn't fully watch the show. But even if the stuff I did watch, actually, I did watch the show, but I didn't finish it. But from what I watched, bro, like I'm just gonna give it a 2 as well, bro. Like, yeah, I wasn't really feeling it, if I'm honest, man.
Cheers.
I think 2 is even a bit too high, but
No, I could easily say it was the worst AEW show that they've done.
100%.
And nice. Possibly, actually, I don't want to say the worst pay per view this year.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't want to rate it because I need to remember what other pay per views happened. So I wouldn't say the worst.
It was definitely worse than SummerSlam and Payback, though.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so it's the worst pay-per-view this year.
So far.
In the last 6 months, I would think it's safe to say. I think I'll give it maybe 2.5. I'm tempted to go as high as 3, maybe 2.75. But I think 2.5 is fair. I think Moxley had probably his best match for a while against MJF. The Kenny Omega, Hangman Page tag match, FTR winning the championships was pretty good. Yeah. But I think that match lasted too long because obviously they had time to fill from Matt Hardy's match. Young Bucks match was good. It was decent, but I think it's one of them ones where you know how good takeovers are. You watch Takeover's coming on, you haven't even watched it yet, you're just excited, you know you're gonna see something.
Mm.
And it's like you just didn't live up to it, so It was okay, but yeah, 2.5.
You don't know about my AEW thing. There's not even a point to even say, Sam, what do you rate it? I don't watch it. I don't rate it anyway.
So what you said in general, though, 0?
AEW's always, it's never been top 5. Like, for me, like, I can't put it as the big three for me anyway. That's the big three wrestling. I don't.
It's too early.
No, it's big three. It's big three. But I'm saying mine. I'll put Impact. Honest, that's just for me, innit?
It's too early for us to be talking about big three. We've only been it for a year. It can't be big three.
But financially, it's a big three.
So. Yeah, financially. Okay. Yeah, of course, financially. But
financially, it's a big three.
On an overall, but
it's got more pool than Impact. Of course, it's got to be big three.
Yeah, of course.
It's the number two company in the
world. Yeah. No. Of course, it is big three.
It's the number two in the world.
It's the big three. It's just, in my opinion, it's just. So, just to let the viewers know, when I say things, there's a lot on my opinion. It's not a general consensus. It's my opinion, innit? Just a kind of statement.
AEW is definitely number three, not number two.
Who's number two?
What's number two?
It's New Japan.
I think after these lot have gutted New Japan was number two.
Yeah.
I don't think anymore. Now that
New Japan wasn't even number two for long.
New Japan, them man have bread. Remember, they've been operating for as long as WWE.
But you're forgetting that there was a period where they lost peas. They lost peas. It's only that the last few years they've started to make their peas back again.
He's got bread, my guy.
I won't lie, they're not in the levels of Tony Khan and that. That man got stupid money. Yeah. That man got stupid. That's what I'm saying, Vince. Tony, go on.
These Japanese guys got money, you know.
It's the pool of going to Japan, though. How many people that are top guys in America go to Japan?
Not anymore, anyway. The past 10 years, I can't really say a big star's gone there.
People that Jericho. Are going there are people that are trying to...
Jericho. Moxley.
Can I ask you a question? I know there's this talk about everyone saying, oh, why didn't they go to AEW? Do you think we would ever, in our lifetime, get an AEW wrestler go back to WWE?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Who do you think that might be? Who would you like to see go back to? Who would you like to see work in WWE? On AEW that has not been on WWE before.
Let me not lie, Chris Jericho is going to go back eventually.
He's going to go back.
He's not.
He will. It's done.
Hall of Fame, he's going back.
Of course he's going back. Let me tell you why Jericho's always got the possibility of going back, because he's cool with everyone.
Yeah.
Jericho's like the only wrestler that can go to Vince's office and say, I want to come back. No problem.
That's some good shit.
Jericho can go to any company in the industry and say, I want to be in. Of course.
I'd love to see MJF in WWE, though. Oh, yeah.
Him and Miz. I think that'd be a decent rivalry, them two.
I've just got this fear
that a lot of people, like, it's always nice to be able to see wrestlers in the WWE ring, but at the same time, we just never know. Like, a lot of them just get mishandled. Like, look at what happened to EC3. EC3, he wasn't the greatest in the ring, but if we're talking someone that's on the mic.
Character-wise,
he's up there.
His mic work will carry him through, you know what I'm saying? But at the same time, they took the mic away from him and he suffered.
If I put it like this then, okay, someone to go to WWE and forget. Like,
and they guaranteed a good push.
Yeah, yeah.
MJF, yeah, I was saying.
Yeah.
Yeah, MJF.
Yeah.
I think FTR left the door open when they left. They didn't come and do all these shoot interviews and didn't start cussing. So I wouldn't mind. Maybe once they start caring about tag teams again in WWE, if they went back.
That depends how long.
Yeah, they may be open to it. Moxley, I don't think no chance in hell he would go back.
Moxley,
especially now his wife has left. There's nothing.
Yeah, Moxley ain't going back.
MJF is a good shout, but I have like I don't know, of the other week when MJF was building up to facing Moxley, and he was doing his little rah-rah presidential speech about how he's going to be AEW. I don't think that fits in his character. I think he should very much be like kind of like a traitor, like I'll go to whoever's giving me the most money, and kind of threatening on TV I'll join the other side. Like, I think that would be better for him than saying he's
a lot of heat.
Yeah, but that's what he wants, no?
Yeah.
I don't think there's any point in him saying he wants to carry AEW on his shoulders. I don't feel, for me anyway, that fits in with his character.
Unless he does some sort of like swerve where like he ends up winning the title and then just like, fuck you lot. I just want to be the face. I don't want to carry this company. Nobody in this company can chat to me. I'm the best, you know, what I said before. Ha ha. You got me. You figured me out. You know what I'm saying? But, I mean, I feel like, MJF, he's I don't know.
Yeah, he's one of their big stars.
No, he is. He is. No,
one thing I do want to ask you lot is, even after all that happened, saw a lot of criticism from a lot of these internet virgins.
I can't lie, I've come off social media, innit? But yeah, talk to me.
Fucking virgin. That's why you might have too much energy. Though I saw a lot of people complaining that AEW had this this thing where they're saying that, yeah, we're going to push the stars of the future. But then the fact that all their champions are former WWE employees, people are complaining, saying, oh, I thought you guys wanted to make...
Why is that a problem?
I don't understand it, because my thing is you can't complain that these people are being treated like shit in one company.
Yeah, yeah. That's,
the minute
that's
they get a push in another company, it's, oh, this is basically an old WWE in a stack.
Why is that a problem?
Because they're fucking virgins, they expect? Man.
Fans, I don't know what the fans expect.
The wrestling community.
This is the reason why that last episode I got to the fans. They don't know what they want. They don't know what they want.
The wrestling community is a confusing place, man.
Fam,
you give them what they want, and they complain.
I'm gonna be honest with you.
But listen, a lot of these, yeah, that's what I'm saying. A lot of these fans, A lot of these men are roasting. A lot of these men play with themselves. A lot of these men don't have a lot. Like, they don't have a life. Do you know what I mean? They're stressed with life. So who do they take out on? The wrestlers. They're not making dough. They're broke. They're depressed. What do you expect them to do? Of course they're gonna say fuck you to someone. I would. Do you know what I mean?
I just find it jarring, because it's like us as fans, and I'm talking like people like us, where we've seen people come into a company, we know their worth, we know how good they are. The minute they leave, we're thinking that, you know what, whatever company you go to, you're going to flourish, because one, you're talented, and two, just off the back of being an ex-WWE star, you're automatically going to get a push. It's nothing new, you know what I'm saying? But then there's other fans that will see it like, oh, this guy's an ex-WWE guy, why are you pushing them? There's people like Pete Avalon.
Keep saying
you.
and that's the problem. But one thing, if we're setting up a new company, because let's not forget, that's what AEW is. If we don't slap the title on Chris Jericho or Jon Moxley from the jump, who's watching this?
Exactly.
If I slap the title on a Pete Avalon or a Kip Sabian, you're going to be like, okay, go watch AEW. Oh, who's there? Kip Sabian's champion.
I hate to bring this guy's name in, but didn't they do the same thing in in WCW when Hulk Hogan went there? How quick did he become champion?
It's business, it's like you bring your main star and you put him in the forefront, it's like the movies.
If you've got a movie and you've got, okay, let's say you've got these sick British actors, yeah, but then you've got Idris Elba, like, okay, Leonardo DiCaprio, Tom Cruise. Bro, who are you gonna put on a poster? Tom Cruise.
He can even be an extra.
Look at that film where The Rock dies. Was The Rock dies in 2 seconds? Samuel Jackson. Samuel Jackson dies in the first scene.
What film?
Bro, he's in the film here with The Rock here and this other guy. I think it's called The Other Guys. It's The Other Guys? The film's called The Other Guys.
I have no idea.
Samuel Jackson's in it. He dies in the first minute.
Look at Stop the Yard. Chris Brown was
a bam, and he's on a poster.
He died in the first 30 minutes.
It's a matter.
You have to sell the product. That is it. So when these men are complaining, and to be fair, these younger men, like I'm using Kip Sabian as an example. Do they want the title straight out the gate for a new company? These men have never been on TV. Like, they've wrestled, yeah, but they ain't been on consistent TV product that comes out weekly. Do they want the pressure of being champion from the jump? Probably not.
They're just naive because because, like, you have to look at it like this. If it wasn't for the fact of these main stars, you're not going to watch the product anyway, exactly. I feel like. Yeah, you won't know these jobbers. So they're just being hypocritical. It's just pathetic. It's just, yeah, all your breath stink.
Do you know it is? I feel like if you come from the WWE, you're automatically a veteran because you've got the TV experience. You've been around people that are like world champions that have been on TV. Like, automatically, you're up there. Like, you have more experience than everyone else. So, of course, they're going to be pushing the WWE guys because they're the most experienced. The guys that have never been on TV are there to learn from the professionals that have. And then they can now, you know, start getting better positions, etc.
Facts.
This is all it is. Like, they brought... I don't even think Zack Ryder has signed a contract with AEW, but they've brought him on obviously because he's Cody's mate, but because of his internet prowess, like what he can do for them on Twitter and stuff like that. He's got a podcast, like it's smart.
It's true. Very, very smart.
Him going to AEW is like to say, like, it's actually like made me respect him even more. Like, he's looking jacked, he's looking good. I feel like give it a couple months or a couple years in AEW, I feel like he'll definitely be.
Don't.
I'm listening. Okay, look. Do you know what? Let me say it first. Let me mark it on all as an African.
I'm
I'm marking it on the wall. Give it a couple years. I said yes. I didn't say next week. I didn't say July 2021. I said yes. He might become one of the big dogs in AEW. I'm just saying, if he goes through a thing, if he goes through like a contract.
Go on, go on. I can see that. That's what I was about to say. I was just about to say that.
Don't look at me like that. Don't doubt me. Don't doubt me like that, bro. Come on, man.
I would like to see Zack Ryder at the top of the card. The issue is already, in what we've seen of him on AEW, and it is the little we've seen of him, he is still just
Zack Ryder.
He's not Matt. He's not even Matt Cardona yet. He's still doing woo yeah. and wait, all of this stuff.
Wait! Hold on, wait a minute. He's still doing. He's still doing woo woo woo.
I've done.
I don't think he shouted it, but man definitely does a jump.
Come on, leave it. But my thing is, like, I look at him and it's like, I respect him. He's Matt Cardona, but I still see Zack Ryder. It's not like when Cody Rhodes came into the indies, man said, okay, cool, I'm starting from the bottom. I'm going to all these shows. Mm. I'm gonna look different. I'm gonna do different moves. Like when he debuted in PWG, I think that was one of the first shows I saw him at, and I was thinking, fuck, like, he's wrestling someone that I know is prominent in the indies, but I know I'm gonna get a good match out of this. I know I'm gonna see something different. Mm. Whereas with Matt Cardona, it's kind of like, I feel like I'm watching Main Event.
Runs and kicks your head enough.
Bro, like, Matt Cardona, I think, I'm not sure how much he has to offer, but I want to see him do well. Mm. Obviously, he's used the fact his friend is running the company to get in. There's nothing wrong with that. But he definitely has to come with something different because, yeah, the whole woo and still throwing up, what's that, the L thing that he does of where he's from or whatever it is. It's just like, this is what put you on the shelf in WWE.
You know what
like,
is?
Don't come shelf yourself.
You know here. What is? In life, yeah, sometimes the nice guy's not going to win. You have to be a prick. Listen, Zack Ryder, just turn heel. Be a bad guy.
And bro, and look at Kurt Hawkins.
Look at Bayley. Bayley is a prime example. At the moment,
and he looks good. Yeah,
you see where I'm coming from? Yeah. Like, I feel like being a nice guy, you have that bad side to you.
I mean, depending on what the angle is, if we end up seeing him go heel, you know what I'm saying? But
I said, man, give him a couple AEW's years,
AEW's like home of heel turns now. I'm tired of
I don't feel like...
Oh, serious?
Yeah, it is.
Oh, okay.
It's a rival, isn't it?
Fam's coming like NWO, just everybody's just coming to just take over the company, man.
Fam, all right, cool. Speaking of NWO, like, I've been on social media, but I follow this account on like Instagram, and I forgot their name. And the people were bringing up the Retribution talk. Retribution cut a promo, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
And their voice was very like fogged out, looking like kind of like some mix. You see Travis Scott's ad libs. So yeah, they were saying, just people saying that how like they think the leader of Retribution is still Roman Reigns. Anyone want to contest? Are you man even invested, bro?
I'm investing in this Retribution.
Was this promo done on Raw?
SmackDown. Yeah, it was on Raw.
You sure?
Yeah, apparently, what's it was on Raw. Retribution are exclusive to Raw.
Yeah, it was on Raw.
But for me, that's thrown me off because this is meant to be a
WWE thing. They're meant to go everywhere.
Why are they just...
They're meant to actually go everywhere.
Why are you saying that you're Monday night?
That's the problem with WWE. They spoil it all the time. Just make it.
That would have made sense, though, if they were exclusive to Raw then, because... How would Roman still be the leader?
Yeah, that's why it's
Roman. Roman's on SmackDown.
Universal
Champion, ain't he? So, it doesn't make sense anyway.
It doesn't make sense. I can't,
But like I said, I feel like, as Del was just touching on, like, why did they have to say Retribution's based in Raw? He just killed the whole thing.
Did they actually announce that? Not on TV, but I think on socials or something.
Yeah, but it still doesn't make sense. Because now it's like, you don't want to take over WWE. No, you just want to take over Raw.
Just Raw.
You know what I'm coming from?
We just want Raw. We just want Raw.
Like, yeah, like, okay.
Not even Raw Underground. We just want Raw. We're the mad guys out of Underground.
You know what I mean? Not even Underground. Like, Bab Afton, they'll be waiting for you if you go to Underground anyway.
Like, there's mad gaps in the logic. Like, even the fact that they didn't just come and put an attack on Raw this past week. And all of a sudden, they had a logo which was loaded onto the Titron. Who done that for them?
Let me defend that. In their defense, I can't lie. They've been mashing work backstage, though. The time when they control the thing, they must have imported it from. Come on, man. I don't doubt these, man. These men are working hard, you know.
They're putting it.
Smash your windows. Come on, man. Eating in the canteen.
Canteen living.
These canteen niggas are getting disturbed, fam. Every night, imagine. You're chilling there. You're not getting a match. You're smacking on some boys. What's the thing? What's the American toast thing that you have chocolate on top? I forgot the name of it. Is that something you put on the toast? The toast thing. Pop tarts. They're stacking on pop tarts. Yeah. And then you know they get banged in the head. They get collapsed in the head, fam. Some guys. Nah. Myth, fam.
I'm not gonna lie. I'm not happy with retribution, man. Just the whole thing just seems off. I feel like it's been botched already.
I think so, and I think it's lasted too long without making like this manifesto thing they've done should have come maybe about 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago.
It should have came before SummerSlam, and SummerSlam should have been the big reveal. But I feel for SummerSlam, they wanted to make it all for Roman. They wanted to make it Roman's night.
Yeah, 100.
You know what I mean? So 100. It wouldn't have made sense if they came on SummerSlam. But what would have made sense if they interrupted a match in SummerSlam, but still kept Roman as the main thing, and we will still always remember that Roman. It's still there because obviously Roman's returned from this long hiatus, isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I feel like it still could have worked, but obviously WWE want to do things special and keep it for probably Night of the Champions. When is that? That's next week, right?
Swear.
2 weeks time. I think it's
bloody hell, bro. Pay per views are just happening. Like, how much pay per views have we had of WWE? Bloody, give it a rest. Sorry, give it a rest, bro.
Apart from Payback, they put after SummerSlam.
Okay, which, maybe that's why I thought that.
I thought for the life of me. You're putting a pay-per-view called Payback a week after SummerSlam. Mm. This has to be their unveiling.
Yeah.
What the hell does Retribution?
Payback was even the actual poster had Retribution's name in it and bit other stuff linking to what they've done.
Retribution weren't there at Payback.
That's our point. Yeah,
they
that's
there.
Our point.
They were meant to be there.
We were watching that together,
concept
right?
Of.
I don't know.
We were chatting on the
SummerSlam. Like, I don't understand. I'm sure if you check synonyms in the dictionary, Payback and Retribution, you're gonna see them under each other, like,
or some or resemblance. Yeah.
There's like just some things that I just think WWE just they just don't clock. I don't know, like, some things.
What did
just
we say
there.
In our prediction video? Sometimes the writing is on the
it's,
wall.
Yeah, it's there.
All you have to do is just.
Yeah,
you know what? But you know what? Maybe WWE's just thrown us all off, and maybe Survivor Series might do a madness. In WWE have done that to us many times in this podcast. We've said things, and they just throw us, and we're like, "Whoa!"
In
WWE
events, sorry, my bad, bro. You go.
I would say if they're gonna do that, SummerSlam, that's unnecessary long term booking, bro. Mm. And they've literally lost us from the beginning. Then
fair
because Survivor Series, they should have at least started the Retribution now. Not even now. When's Survivor Series? November, right?
November.
They should have started the whole thing in October. Then that's a 1 month. That should be a 1 month rivalry done on 2K on WWE 2K Universe. I would put that as 1 month. A short-term rivalry.
You can't cause havoc.
And there'll be no backstage segments. I won't allow it. Straight everything gonna be in the match. Everything gonna be during the match. Invasion every night.
You can't cause havoc for more than 4 weeks. Even 1 week. There's police.
It makes Vince McMahon look incompetent.
How are they getting?
What the hell?
How are they getting into the arena every week?
Like every no night during COVID, during pandemic. No, I'm not being silly here. Man, them back me up. Help me out.
It's true.
In the logic is vast.
No, there's no correlation at all. No, just don't make.
In WWE's defense, yeah, the writers probably do come up with some good stuff. Vince McMahon rips it up on the day and they have to rewrite it last minute. So I feel like that's the reason why there's so many cracks within storylines.
Apparently the last 3 weeks on Raw, when Vince McMahon has turned up at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, he's just ripped it and said they're starting again.
But why is Vince so cruddy like this? What goes through the man's head, bruv? Seriously. You're an old man. So I don't even want to mock him, you know what, before one day we might see each other. But you know what I mean? At the end of the day, it's mad. Vince, come on, man. I've got big respect for you.
Vince always has a vision of how he wants it. And if he doesn't agree with your vision, he's not going to hear you out.
Fam. I don't blame him, though. He's made something.
Unless if you do it, and you slyly impress him, and he's like, okay, cool, I'll mess with that. Let's do it.
No, but
I feel like even... Okay, no, I was actually going to say something. No, I don't think I... No.
I was gonna say
even I feel like even the John Cena thing was like, the whole John Cena gimmick was at the beginning was actually a fluke.
Yeah.
I feel like right. Stephanie McMahon said do it, but obviously the whole thing happened where John Cena was at the back of the coach, was spraying bars, and Stephanie goes, oh shit, I like that. Then she was like, oh, why didn't you wear just like Vanilla Ice and come to the ring the next day? And I feel like he'd done that. Not letting Vince McMahon know, and he just done it, and after he just caught on. Do you know what I mean?
I think
it's true.
Stephanie was running SmackDown them times.
Yeah, she was.
That's
she
probably
was.
Why he kind of bypassed Vince. Obviously, the boss's daughter. And yeah.
Is there no? There's no more GM on SmackDown or Raw no more, is there?
Nope.
They took that off quickly.
Yeah. So what? This draft that we were about to get, did that just get scrapped? And how we draft?
It's not a draft.
Drafting if there's no GM, who's picking? Like, where's the fun in this?
It's gonna be random.
Is Retribution the new GM?
Who was the person that fired Nia Jax?
Nia Jax got fired.
That Pat Buck. Pat Buck. He's a producer.
Yeah, it might be. I don't know. He might be in charge running the matches.
I like how they're using him and. What's his name? Alec Pierce. Because because it's like we. When they come and do these GMs all the time, they always make it like the heel authority thing, and it's been done, innit? Just have someone like William Regal, who's on NXT, someone to just step in when something gets messy, or someone to just make a match. Like, that's all I think it ever needs to be. Like.
Yeah,
you're telling me we should bring back Teddy Long.
Oh, 100.
Hala, hala, hala. You go 1-on-1 with the Undertaker.
Who would you? Who would you?
Nah, player.
Who do you actually make go one on one?
Retribution.
Who?
Yeah, Matt said,
Who? Teddy Long?
Like, do you know Teddy Long gonna say you're gonna go 1-on-1 with the Undertaker, right? So who would he actually go one on one? Like, who would actually
probably
make
Braun Strowman.
I was gonna say the Fiend.
The Fiend.
Every night.
1-on-1 with the Fiend.
Not the Fiend that we've been getting this month.
Yeah, the red cage fiend. Yeah, that fiend.
That's two nightmares in one, fam.
That's funny.
Boogeyman might come back. I feel like Boogeyman always come back when Teddy Long's there, you
know. are you lot invested in this? I think it's SmackDown, actually. This Sami Zayn and... Is it Raw? AJ, SmackDown, Sami, SmackDown, Jeff. It's a bit meaty, isn't it?
I'm 50-50, I like Sami Zayn a lot.
There's no but.
Oh, okay.
No, I like Sami Zayn.
Okay, there is a but.
Yeah, yes.
There is a but. The only but is, I feel like the whole double champion thing is a bit played out. That's the only thing I'm not really
That's why I'm not really happy
with. Impact. We've just seen a lot in it.
But just put them all in a triple threat and let's just see some good wrestling.
That's what we're getting at Clash of Champions.
Yeah.
But if we do get like Sami Zayn in a place where he's putting on a good match, because when Sami Zayn's heel, you don't really get you get just a heel match. You don't really get
a good Sami Zayn match.
But if we're able to get like a motivated Sami Zayn, then
listen,
it's gonna be sick.
NXT Sami Zayn back, you know.
Yeah, that's
want that one. Aluva kicks out of nowhere. We want that one back, not this.
That can be said for a lot of superstars, though, man. Like people would want a new Japan Shinsuke. Do you know what I mean? People would want freaking NXT or beginning Cesaro. Do you know where I'm coming from, like? WWE, innit?
You know what I think they're gonna do? I was watching Raw the other day, and obviously Cesaro Shinsuke came over.
To speak to Street Profits. Montez Ford, superstar. Remember I said it. Carry on.
So, I think that they're about to unify the tag team championships because the tag division in WWE.
It's the worst.
It's terrible.
It's the worst tag team division.
It's terrible. It's true. Like. They might as well have one good, like how they have the women's tag team, everyone just goes across the brand. They may as well do the same thing with the guys. Because I think at the same time, I've heard rumors that they wanted to change the belts, or they've changed the belts already, and they haven't launched a new thing. But yeah, I just thought otherwise, what is this brand invitational crap that Cesaro and Shinsuke came with? Like,
I think that's what I think anyway.
Remember they were doing this thing where they were doing this initiative where each week, one person from the other brand... The logic is just dying on me. I don't get it. Like, even though I haven't been watching it, but I'm thinking like...
It's like they've almost destroyed the whole concept of a draft and the brand split.
And it's like they'll now implement a rule, but then they'll have like... They'll say one person from this brand can come, but now see five men from the other brand come. Then they'll stop doing it for time, and then...
Or it's the same person that comes.
You know what I think's happening? Obviously, before everything I said, that Vince doesn't like when he doesn't come up with the idea. So I feel like what's happening, these writers are writing shit, doing it, and obviously Vince has not vetted it or something, and they're like, you know, fuck that, we've done it. And I think that's what's happening halfway. Because some of the stuff that's happening does not make sense. Doesn't make sense. Like, even, what's it, the whole the brand split right now doesn't even make sense, bro. Why are we getting a brand split? And people say the brand split was happening because of Fox. Fox asked for the brand split. I don't even believe that shit. Do you get what I mean? Like, so I feel like a lot of things are just...
I wouldn't be surprised if Fox did do that, but...
No, remember, they wanted their own brand. They wanted SmackDown to be a bit more, like,
sports-centric. Yeah.
Raw to be a bit more entertainment, innit? So I feel like they did want that brand split.
Okay.
I don't know. When it comes to Vince McMahon,
You can have an idea today. The moment that man goes home to sleep and he wakes up, that idea is getting thrown away.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, can you hear it?
I'll speak into it. Oh,
oh my bad.
Literally
my bad.
The great, literally the greatest heel in WWE history. Literally.
Fam.
It, I think, yeah.
Literally.
You can't really debate that, Vince.
No arguments.
He's literally. A villain. He's a villain.
It's the greatest heel.
Once Dark Side of the Ring comes out, you'll know.
The greatest.
Vince's Dark Side of the Ring will be.
No, you know what the thing is. They wouldn't do it. It's like exposing Trump.
Yeah, yeah.
He won't do it.
You have to wait.
It's too much. It's too powerful. The man will have to be dead and gone for a good few. You know Adolf Hitler? You know that, like 50 years.
You think it'll run when he's dead?
Oh, yeah.
Nah, I don't think that'll run either. We're going to get Jeffrey Epstein's situation. People are going to start dying.
I'm finished.
Man. I want that. Vince
bro,
is powerful.
Lying,
Vince
is dying, bro.
Vince is.
Do you know who, fam?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. People might commit suicide because Vince, the influence is serious.
Yes. I'm gonna just put things straight in it. This is wrestling, yeah. So there's also the wrestling side and the thing side. So, man, we're gonna talk about the thing side real quick. Oh, have you not seen what's happened to Jeffrey Epstein and that, fam? Apparently, someone dressed up as a FedEx guy and shot
the judge's son.
Fam,
mad.
Yo, whoa!
I can't even laugh at that. Bro.
Whoa! That's why I just went. Ooh.
Do you get what I mean? FedEx, ooh. Here's your parcel. Bow. Nah, it's done. But yeah, back to the wrestling.
I wonder what was in the parcel though.
Like, I wonder what was in there, fam.
Yeah, like, was it a real parcel or was it just...
Nothing, it was a hitman job.
Man just capsized the man's head like
that's
that.
That's harsh,
Jesus.
Man.
It's done.
Jesus.
SmackDown, you watch SmackDown? We still talking about SmackDown?
Yo, let's chat about SmackDown. Yeah, SmackDown. Roman Reigns.
Yeah, Roman Reigns.
I'm invested in this.
Let me tell you what throws it off. This Uso thing. Why is he fighting?
We'll get to that.
That doesn't make sense. Seriously.
Very good.
Yeah, they are. We'll get to that. Mandem, quick one before we even start this year. Is everyone here invested in Roman right now?
100%.
We're part of a Roman fan club, yeah?
Yeah.
Cool, let's move.
We've called it from day. Let that Roman be himself, and he'll.
But I need to see if he's going to still wear the singlet bulletproof vest.
I love your uncle for his singlet.
The fan club question.
Remember, I've been saying it for time. As long as he gets rid of that bulletproof vest or whatever he's wearing, fam, I hate it.
Yeah.
You know what? I heard that bulletproof vest does something to protect his back, to help his back.
Oh, okay.
I think
the bottom part of it is like a thing. I'm not even trying to be rude. We want to see that chest.
Treating Roman like his pinky or something.
This is gonna sound bare.
I'll bleep it.
Would you? This sounds mad. It just sounds mad. Would you prefer Roman like in a vest or not a vest?
That's not bad.
No, but it just sounds mad. I don't know why.
That's some guilt. That's some real guilt. Like.
I was getting ready to edit that out.
What do you prefer?
I wanted no vest, bro.
Why are you even answering?
It just sounds weird.
That's the same thing you lot are creating a wrestler, though.
Yeah.
No?
It's true.
Mandem, help me out.
Yeah, I saw a tweet earlier. This is not wrestling related, but someone said, men swear their men will be homophobic, but will create their dream men on NBA 2K.
Yes,
it's true. It's
but
true.
I create myself on NBA 2K.
That's true.
I face scan. I create myself.
What hairstyle do you use?
Right? Just a fade.
Have you got a fade now?
But
do you know what I mean? That's a G man.
Wait, was that not my prominent hairstyle before lockdown?
What crest was your guy wearing?
He was wearing Jordans.
Hey, what was his casual drop? I know they have the casual drop.
Wear shorts and t-shirt.
What shorts and t-shirt?
Did you not see me in shorts the other day, prick?
I just tried to set you up.
So with the question that Sam asked, would you prefer a vest or no vest? You'd rather not wear a vest.
Last time I saw no vest was in FCW. It looked weird. Him wearing vest and pants and the tape, but to be honest, I don't. It's weird. I don't want him to wear the bulletproof vest, yeah. but I don't want him. I want him
to be comfortable.
Yeah, I want it to look like he's still Roman. Do you get what I mean? One thing I want to see Roman in, yeah, it's very weird. I saw a picture on Instagram. He had like, Roman had, they edited a skin fade on his head. Okay. It looked sick. Roman looked sick. Yeah, it looked sick.
I was like, yo, Roman.
Yeah, like yeah. I mess with that still.
Basically, but that Uso haircut.
Yeah, the Uso haircut. But no, but it was lower than that. It was actually skin fade, proper skin fade. Yeah. Man. So that it'd be nice. But yeah, man, I don't know.
Yeah, it is.
So how are you feeling about that? Roman
without a vest, he just looks more like a wrestler, innit? Because we've seen bare wrestlers without having to wear a bulletproof. You know what I'm saying? Mm. So just him without a vest is just.
He might look a bit common.
You know
you think?
Do you know what I had to get
used to over the years? You lot are gonna just probably laugh at me. You might even agree. You see when Brock Lesnar started wearing shorts, I wasn't used to that on WWE.
I was
more used to the pants and the whole. Do you know that? Because he had a different type of boot, and the boot was like. Look like hunting boots rather than actual wrestling boots.
Do you watch UFC?
I didn't watch his UFC.
That's why.
Do you know what I mean? I didn't watch
his
UFC.
Because UFC started wearing those shorts. But even still,
I think enough time had passed where he could come back and do something different. And I guess that's why it might have looked weird at first. But then, obviously, especially with the UFC background, then he's like, it makes sense that that's the kind of new character. And he kind of did bring that over as a character.
Yeah.
But I think with Roman, like I think we all called for a change of music as well when he was to come back, not the Shield music. I think we spoke about that, and I think a change of music. Yeah, but I think it's become too iconic for him now.
When we went to watch SmackDown Live, and we heard Roman's theme song. Bro, what
were
we
guys? Yeah, it was a vibe still. Fam. It was a vibe. I wasn't even live.
Played on a gram set. It's getting wheeled up. From.
Were you guys? Because it was Roman Reigns or because it sounded like The Shield?
Nah, the beat, bro. When I hear the entrance song, I don't think of The Shield no more. I think of Roman Reigns.
I just think, when are you going to change it? I'm tired of it, fam.
So I see Seth Rollins. When Seth Rollins one is still, burn it down.
Yeah.
Do you know AEW theme?
Generic.
Yeah.
I don't even know.
It is. I'm just thinking, what the hell? Okay.
You know what SmackDown Shotty Mafia has the list of what it should say?
Yeah.
One of those.
Oh, it has one of those things. It was angered pop star or something.
Yeah.
You know the thing, wrestling tunes are like, they have to be so, especially within that first kind of chord. There has to be something that happens when you sit up, like Austin, the glass smashes. You know Austin's about. You see what I mean? And The Rock, no, can you smell? There has to be something.
Have you not realised that? I think that only happened with Jim Johnson. Jim Johnson had a thing where with all these beats, it's like a you bit can like Pharrell. Pharrell has that four beat. But with Jim Johnson, he always had that same glass.
No. Allow me.
I was slick.
So what I was saying is this, I feel like Jim Johnson always had like a signature thing where it was either, for example, Undertaker's theme song, ding, you know he's coming. The Rock's thing, if you smell, bam, there's that break. Stone Cold's thing, whatever, cool. But I always feel like they always had that same thing, and with the new song that's coming right now, everything just feels like mash it up, let them go in. Do you get what I mean? There's no sort of like, okay, with the Shield, there used to be that thing of Echo, Lima, Sima. Yeah.
It's the intro. Shield.
That was it.
It's
that was
the
there.
Intro.
Do you get what I mean?
That's the key.
I feel like people forget that's Jim Johnson as well. Mm.
The Shield is Jim Johnson.
Yeah.
There you go.
That's one of his last tunes. Yeah.
There you go. Do you get what I mean? Even Shawn Michaels. I think that was the early one. Even back now, the new one don't sound like that.
What about Benoit's one? What's that? That went to.
They got that from a band.
Yeah, that's from a band. That's from a band.
But even that, there's even a pause in that, bro.
I think with a lot of them songs around that time as well, what Jim Johnson used to do, he used to send people references. So he'd send people a reference for a song. So like the 3-6 might actually not the 3-6, but there's a few tunes where he'll send people references of how he wants the song to be done. So that way they can perform it. So obviously he'll get credit for it as well. So. Yeah, he had his hand in a lot of things.
Yeah, he's a legend.
I can't lie.
Nah, most def.
I don't know. What's he doing now? Like, I feel like we slightly need him back, man. Like, with obviously the Keith Lee sort of situation that's happened as well. I wasn't really happy with him coming in wearing whatever he's wearing now. But obviously, I think
like a Power Ranger.
But let me tell you something about Keith Lee. I don't think he's even spoken about too tough. Keith Lee's gonna go far in this industry right now, man. Because the way WWE pushing, even the way he reversed the RKO, I've never seen someone stand up the RKO like that. But a man went to RKO, he stood like this.
But you know what? But you know what? The same thing Carly did when he first came. The same thing these big men did.
No, this is different.
What is going to
wait?
Do,
are you comparing Keith Lee to Carly?
Why do you clash with him? I don't understand this guy.
Wait for me.
Okay. Oh, wait, are you comparing?
Do you need help? You need help. I'll help you out. Hey, go.
I feel embarrassed.
Go.
I get what you're trying to say. Obviously, when these new
don't cap, are, you don't get it.
No, let me help. I feel like you're trying to say that when these new wrestlers come on the scene, they get a big push, right? Mm. Is that what you're talking about? But I feel like with Keith Lee's one, it's completely different, bro. Like we've seen this guy from the Indies to NXT. If you watched him at, I think it was even a time when he fought at, what do you call this thing that used to go to at Brian? I saw on YouTube.
Oh, Riptide.
He's like Riptide.
Big up Riptide.
You know what I mean? Big up Riptide all the time, man.
No, and Keith,
like,
is good.
You know what I mean? I feel like this one's completely different. Like,
but for him to go all the way, I don't know why I just can't see it.
Why? Who's in the picture now that
even
can stop
him? Even his promos are a bit... Mm.
But no, who's in the picture now that
he
can stop him?
Like, it just sounds a bit waste. Like, the way Keith talks, he's like, yeah. And then Drew... That's why I know, but for me.
But how did Viscera talk? Tell me.
Oh, come
Viscera on. Viscera don't even have. You know, the maddest thing is Viscera don't really. He's a monster. That's how Viscera. He's a bit. He's a bit outrageous. I can't lie to you. I can't even lie to you, but like.
So wait.
No, Keith is hard. I'm not discrediting him. Sorry. Keith is hard, isn't it?
You just don't know if he's
going to
be a top star.
I don't know if WWE are I don't know if they're going to use him well. You lot were saying the same thing about
Velveteen. Okay, I was about to say that.
Respect
Velveteen. Okay, cool.
Velveteen X'd himself.
Velveteen fucked himself over.
So
on that regard, because we said to you, no matter what, he's going to get to the top. I'll take back what I said about Velveteen Dream. I feel like with what he does in his extracurricular activities, he's gone and he's X'd himself. It doesn't take away from him being a good wrestler, but at the same time, I find it very hard for WWE to put themselves in a position to put him there.
I mean, I don't want to get into politics, but so obviously the Velveteen Dream was in the scandal with sending like pictures, nudes to like underage people. And apparently whatever. I don't know. But the only reason he's not behind bars right now is because the lawyer found like some loophole like within the state of Florida.
Oh yeah, if you're under a certain age, you can
That's it.
So I think if you're under the age of 21 and you're sending messages to people under 18, apparently I don't know. Don't quote me, but it's something along those lines.
So morally, he's done a madness.
Yeah,
but in the court of law, it's fine.
Yeah. I wonder how everyone's thinking.
And there were certain people that were lying. Like there were certain things that was happening that was untrue. Okay. But at the same time, that nigga did that shit. So he did that shit. He's guilty as fuck. But Keith Lee, I do see like there's not that many wrestlers, especially like with the ones coming up. There's not that many that I do see going to the top. Besides Montez, well, let's forget that like, people like Big E, the Kofis, the Bobby Lashleys, people like Keith Lee, people like. Montez. Those are the two people at the moment that I can actually see as being viable black faces of the company.
Dawkins, I don't know who else I might see who could creep up. Yeah, and it's very underrated. I thank God for his heel turn, Cedric Alex fucking Zandra.
My guy,
I'll tell you that for a fact.
I've been screaming
when
in the group.
He had a bit of his pop when he was clean, when he was jumping from the Raw. What was it now?
The signage,
and all that stuff. Because obviously they were pushing him in the main event. You see, I'm coming from. Then he kind of went down. But now I see this heel turn with Hurt Business. I feel like Cedric can really like enhance. Like an evolute. Like he can really enhance himself, like an Orton,
100%.
And develop himself into a star. I see Cedric, and you're good in the ring. You can cut a promo. Do you see where I'm coming from? Mm-hmm. Like Cedric could be that guy. Keith, okay, but I don't know, man.
Do you think Cedric over Keith in terms of who has the potential to be a bigger star?
I don't know. I might get slaughtered for saying it.
To an extent,
yeah.
I think star power right to be like WWE champion is Keith Lee.
Yeah, it's Keith.
But I think Cedric Alexander could have a very dominant career, like Kofi Kingston X, like in the middle of the card. Maybe one day reach the top.
Yeah.
But now he's definitely in the right hands to cultivate what he's got to to give him something. Like,
he's got MVP, Shelton Benjamin, and Bobby Lashley on his side. So he's got like three veterans now able to mentor him. Like, yeah, he's in good hands.
I think definitely with the work MVP's been doing, that this was needed for
something. MVP's changed the industry. I feel like he's changed the
dynamic.
What's the word for it? He's changed the dynamic of black wrestlers in WWE. I feel like coming to the main roster and getting a name for yourself. I feel like it's weird.
Like, he's obviously worked at the Hurt Business. I feel like he's got more stuff to do.
100
he's got to do. I feel like he can easily work at the Street Profits.
I can look at him,
bringing Bear Man.
For me,
I'm not trying to say I don't want a Nation of Domination shit. We don't want that no more. Mm. I'm saying that he can actually make these guys like
stars.
Believable.
It's very simple.
Believable. Do you got me?
Three best managers in the industry right now. I say Zelina, Paul, and MVP.
Yeah. Mm. You know what's mad? MVP. He was meant to retire, you know, and then he was retired from in ring. Came back.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think he's got some work. He wants to improve,
but he wants to work more on that managerial role, innit? So, like I said, I can see him as a Paul Heyman. Like, give it maybe another five years.
Defo, the MVP is gonna hang. He's gonna stick around for a long time,
and that's where I can understand. Okay, let me kind of take it back a bit. That's when I can understand the Keith Lee kind of growing. I feel like he might have an encounter with MVP soon. Not now. I'm not saying straight away.
Yeah, but in time to
in future times.
He's going to have an encounter with Bear Man. Just know that if he's still there for that long.
You know that word, but, encounter with MVP. You know? Well. Everyone that encounters MVP, they change.
They change, yeah.
They change.
It's true.
I think it was at Payback where Keith Lee had a backstage encounter with JBL.
That was that.
What were they doing there? Like
that was weird, but it was good to see JBL.
It was something there I liked.
Yeah,
like just something different.
I feel like JBL. You know what it felt like? It felt like JBL was like, because JBL's always been that type of mentor, in terms of kind of how can I explain it? In kind of saying, you scratch my back, I scratch your back.
Yeah.
Even the same thing with Shawn Michaels, if you remember, like 10 years ago when he got Shawn Michaels in that trap. I feel like he's probably kind of sending that same proposition to Keith. Like, I can help you here. Mm. You just need to do this, do that, this.
Yeah. The only link I can think of is that they're both from Texas. Other than that, I can't think of anything else.
Oh, shit. Yeah, yeah,
that's the only thing I can think
of. Yeah.
But even in terms of like Cedric Alexander, him now being a heel, I hope that doesn't limit him. I hope him being a heel doesn't limit his in-ring stuff. Because we've seen people like Buddy Murphy who have been a heel, but have been able to do whatever they want with it, as opposed to people like Sami Zayn where they can do whatever they want, but then when they now turn heel, they knock it down a bit and not do all their excellent moves in it. If we get the Cedric Alexander we want to see versus Ricochet, I think that's the feud that we're trying to get now. Hands down, I'm saying this now. You guys are watching me. We are going to get the best match of the year. I've said it now.
Yeah, yeah, facts.
If we're given the Cedric Alexander that we want to see, whatever pay-per-view they now do, Ricochet versus Cedric, we're going to get the best match.
Big
NK, you're probably thinking, no, it's going to be Okada versus someone. No.
Every Cedric, Okada. I rate him, though, very hard. But
this could be the best match of the year. Easily.
Yo, it's Anafi here, and you're listening to the Wrestling Podcast by the Mandem, for the Mandem. Blah, blah, blah.
Mandem, so basically, I think it's a perfect segue. As you're talking about Hurt Business and factions and whatever. So I wanted to, you know, present our new segment. This segment's called Was It Actually That Good? So every week we're going to be discussing certain things. So it could be wrestle, it could be like an event, it could be a moment, it could be a faction, it could be a superstar. We're actually going to discuss if it actually was that good. So for today, I think it's best to start off quite in the middle, quite easy. Everyone kind of knows them. Evolution. So we're going to start with Evolution. Was Evolution actually that good? You don't have to disagree. You can agree. But it's just the basis of the whole thing. So where do you want to start? Who wants to go first? Would you think Evolution is actually that good?
I'll go first. Evolution was cold. Ric Flair, Triple H, Batista, Orton, all world champions. They have like 32 or more world championships all between them. So Evolution, they done bits. And plus they changed, I wouldn't say they changed the game. They had a huge influence in that 2003 to 2004 era, but like they were dominating. They were a dominating faction, and I haven't really seen a faction like that in a long time besides the Shield, where all of them become world champions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree.
Like, no,
to be real, you see when you put on the group chat, I kind of said it was like it's a no-brainer because
no, but there's I have a point to talk about. Let me say my point. So I therefore feel like Revolution was sick, but I'll get to the but after. Ooh. I think Revolution was sick. I feel like the Revolution was sick because they didn't follow a lot of these factions. Sort of format where, okay, cool. If I beat you up so many times, you're gonna join us. There wasn't none of that. Mm. You couldn't join.
You can be an affiliate. That's it.
You can
it,
be
really.
Affiliate, but yeah. You can't actually be part of the Revolution. I like that, and also like the fact that they had wrestlers in there that actually, like, obviously they built them up to a level where some of them are Hollywood stars and some of them are still stars in WWE, i.e. Randy Orton, i.e. Batista, and also like the fact that they had two former champions. Two former champions. So they had Ric Flair, they had Triple H. They both accomplished everything they needed to accomplish at that time. So they've all been champions, and wherever they've been, Ric Flair's dominated WCW, all this sort of stuff. And they had these two newbies that just burst on our scene. The first time we saw Batista was holding a briefcase with a chain around his neck. when he was Deacon Batista. Yeah, he was based in Usher at a church.
For bald head,
it didn't make sense. Society. Do you know what I mean? They took him from that and they put him into they basically just watered him and look where he is now. Do you know what I mean?
Mm. Superstar now.
Randy Orton came as a baby face, like jumping off the top ropes and stuff, but fam, can you see Randy jumping off the top rope right now?
Orton will never do. Never again. Never.
Randy is. Randy can't be a face fully again, and that's cause of Revolution. Like, it's mad, but yeah, I agree with the whole Revolution being as good. My only issue is, can I say you might agree with me or anyway. My only issue was this: when they brought them back, I forgot when it was Batista and Triple H. We didn't need that. We don't want to turn Evolution into some sort of like AEW thing when it not AEW. So, wow, I'm provoked. We don't want to turn Evolution into this new NWO thing where we're bringing them back as legends and they're gonna fight. And after the match looks fatigued, leave them where they are. Like, I thought Evolution has done their bits. Like the Four Horsemen will never come back on our screens, but we know that Four Horsemen are one of the best factions.
Well, AEW are screaming Four Horsemen. Yeah, never.
We don't need that. We don't need it. But like, obviously there can be remakes, but we will never see the Four Horsemen team up again. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
obviously
big
they're old now, but back in the day we will never see them team up again.
But I don't. Yeah. I slightly don't think Evolution will ever come back again.
What I'm saying is this: Evolution came back. They came back again at WrestleMania, right? WrestleMania or when?
We didn't need that.
And I feel like stuff like that like kind of dampened the whole Evolution thing, because when I was young, I was fully invested in Evolution. That's the first ever time I actually liked, actually, I've always liked heel factions. But that's like, you know, I like, when I saw that, I was like, yeah, I like heel factions, you know what I mean? But then bringing them back on like WrestleMania or before WrestleMania kind of like dampened it for me. And like, you brought them back for them to like break up again. And it's like, why? Do you know what I mean? Mm. I feel like that was kind of like a low point for Evolution for me.
Yeah.
But other than that, they're one of the best factions I've ever seen. And I fully agree with that statement.
Yeah, for me, I get what you're saying. For me, I wasn't too fussed because at that time they could still go. It's not like they were like the Midnight Express where they it's not like Triple H faced Sting. We had the NWO and DX come out, and it's not like these men are washed. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Randy is still going. Triple H is all has always been in the best shape of his life. But Batista can. You know, get back into it. You know what I'm saying?
Old strings in the ring don't need to be as physical anymore.
You know what I'm saying? So for me, I didn't really, I wasn't invested, but I didn't care it's not like they were in a place where they could injure themselves. And
all four of those characters work so good together. You can bring them back and let them talk. Well, that's their presence.
That's my point, though. You basically just said what I said. Like, when Evolution used to come out back in the day, everyone used to be invested, no matter what, because you know they was going to give someone a thumping. It's not Hurt Business right now. You see Hurt Business on screen, you're invested because you're like, who are they going to thump next? It could be the screens that they tump up. They didn't like want to support us. You know what I mean? But it's like when they bought back Evolution, like it's like I feel like I wasn't investing in it, and I thought I kind of felt like, fam, what are these lot doing, bro? Like, we don't need it. You bought them back for us to get this whole thing about Batista and Triple H. You could have easily bought back Batista to say, yo, I'm back in WWE. I've got beef with him, but he didn't have to bring back the whole Evolution for them to stand on the Titan Trump and do that thing again.
No.
Do you get what I mean?
No, I get what you mean, but I disagree.
It didn't need the Evolution for us.
I do disagree. Evolution
I feel like they needed to come back. When they came back, the place was absolutely electric.
No, but it
electric.
Look, no offense to what you're.
Are you talking in terms of when they when they was with the authority, then they had the feud of the Shield? Or are you talking about that one time that they came for SmackDown?
For SmackDown.
I think the time
because if it's, yeah, that was hard.
That was hard. I thought you were talking about the Feud of Shields.
Actually, I'm talking when they came out for when,
before WrestleMania.
Thing. Yeah, and after
Batista thing, yeah.
So when Batista dragged Ric Flair, that
yeah,
time.
Yeah, that.
Okay, that was after the SmackDown episode. That was after the SmackDown episode.
If I'm honest, the Shield thing, I don't even remember.
But that was after the reunion, because the reunion happened, yeah, when they were on SmackDown. And Batista said, the only thing you haven't done is beat me.
Yeah. That's what you're talking about.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say.
But you see how hard that was,
though. I think that was good, though.
Very good. Very, very good.
Yeah, that wasn't really, that was hard.
Yeah.
I think I'm getting confused with the whole Shield thing, because I don't even remember the Shield thing.
The whole Shield thing.
How many times did they come back? Was it twice?
They've come back twice.
Once in the ring, as a proper feud, and then he came back for a reunion, which wasn't really, that was just a seed for Triple H versus Batista. Yeah.
Mm.
Okay, cool. Then I think I've confused myself there, but yeah, I don't feel like they need to come back basically. Yeah.
The first time against the Shield. Yeah. I thought it was a good launch pad for them to be like, it's similar to Evolution beating Rock and Sock Connection.
Yeah.
You've been able to beat this team that were formidable.
Oh, so you're seeing it as a
possible, not possible.
No, but it's just a launch pad, isn't it? Yeah.
Okay, cool. It's like if these new young boys beat
a certain stature of your elite.
It's not like someone beating Goldberg. Goldberg is way past his prime. He's shit now. You know what I'm saying? So you're going to get someone that they can still go. You can still get a good 20-minute match out of. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah, I think Evolution around that 2003-2004 period that Laps mentioned. I think they were probably one of the best things on TV for me. I know for a lot of people, Triple H's done a lot of wrong, writing his own stories, he's done a lot of wrong, not giving up the belt maybe to Booker T at the time and other stuff like that. But I mean, like you mentioned already, Anafi, like Randy Orton emergence was brilliant, how they used him. Mm-hmm. Batista, you know, they've said in Ultimate, like loads of documentaries and stuff, he was on his way out of the company because that Deacon thing weren't working. Before Triple H picked him up. Again, documentaries have said Ric Flair was in a very bad place before Triple H said, put Rick with me, let him kind of find himself again. So, in terms of the wider picture, they done a lot. And then, of course, like we said, they made two future world champions out of Batista and Randy Orton. The turn on Randy Orton was just something else.
Yeah,
one of the best.
Batista and Triple H slow burn to... You know, eventually Batista choosing
even the contract on Goldberg. Even the contract on Goldberg when he put 100 bags on his head.
Brilliant.
And Batista won the contract for their own. It just shows everything's in house.
That's when he came back from his injury, isn't it?
I feel like the story for Evolution, it writes itself all the time.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Always writes itself. Like even the whole thing of it, like you shagged Randy Orton, and then Batista shagged you. Do you know what I mean? It's like that's one thing I liked about Evolution. The writing of it was sick. And was it Triple H? Do you think it was all Triple H?
Yeah, it was all Triple H.
Yeah, it's definitely Triple H.
And that's the...
No, but do you actually think everything was all Triple H?
No, it's definitely Triple H. 100.
At that point, they've said Triple H was already backstage going into this COO position. They were kind of training him for it.
Mm.
So by then, he was already writing his storylines, maybe running it past the boss. Yeah, but, you know, when his missus was the boss's daughter, like, he was always going to kind of get...
going to have that leeway.
Yeah, that leeway. So... But yeah, I think, and about their second run around 2013, 2014, I never really class anyone's second run as anything serious. Like even the Shield's second run, like...
Okay, actually, no. Wrong. Brock Lesnar's second run is respected.
That's different.
You see where I'm coming from?
I mean when these factions reform.
Okay, when factions reform.
Okay, look at DX, come on.
It's true, yeah. DX is a drag.
That's for another day, innit? But I want to just touch on it quickly. So you don't feel like DX coming back as another faction didn't damage the way you look at them?
What do you mean? Sorry, say that again.
As in, don't you think when DX came back for that second time, when the Santa hats and all this sort of stuff and the kiss my cock, was it kiss my cock?
Kiss my cock.
Don't you think that made you look at DX?
When it was just him and Michaels?
Yeah, don't you think that was dead?
No, that wasn't dead. Wait a minute.
No, wait, I'm trying to understand.
When DX come back, yeah? DX came back as Triple H and Shawn Michaels when they were beefing the Big Show, Vince, and that.
Yeah.
What, you're telling me that run was dead?
I didn't enjoy it.
Wow,
that's
what, that's dropping all shit on the spirits.
Oddman,
that was hard. Wait, no, that was hard. Nah, that was hard, bro.
Look, like,
what, are you telling me that second one was swag? Siri, man, them, yeah. I'm looking at all of you lot. Swear, Dan, yeah, yeah.
Listen, it's always good. It's always good when you know they tear the shirt, the DX thing is under it, or the same with the shield. You get that initial pop. You get their initial first match, and then it's done.
That's
Then it's done. Like, that's DX second run. I'm sorry. In the Ruthless Aggression era.
You cannot compare it to the beginning of DX. 98 DX.
No.
I actually agree.
No. But you cannot now slander and say that the second run was not good.
I'm just saying it's not as good as the first. If it's not going to reach the heights of the first. And it's not just nothing on DX. We've seen it with Evolution. We've seen it with The Shield. There's probably others. If it's not going to reach the heights of the first, just leave it alone. Keep it for the one-off, the Saudi show maybe. Just
I get that.
I'm sorry. When it comes to DX, yeah, I feel like that's going to be another episode. That'll probably go for an hour because there's a lot of stuff you can talk about in there, but. Personally, the first DX that came out was when they had China, Shawn Michaels, and Triple H. I enjoyed that.
Wait. There's many DX. Well, after you had Road Dogg and Billy Gunn.
Yeah,
the X Pac.
Yeah,
I liked that as well. I really liked that. Better than I feel like not. To be honest,
Be careful what you're going to say.
The second one was low-key better than the first one.
Yes.
The second, as in when Triple H became the lead. Yeah, that was better than...
Triple H was running it.
Okay, cool. Triple H's DX was better than Shawn Michaels. So we got three DX runs, basically. There's five. There's actually five. There's too many. I'll be honest with you, the DX run that I remember the most was the 2006 one, the Shawn Michaels and Triple H.
You remember that?
That was my first. No,
you're so bad, man. You don't have to understand. He's young. No offense to you, bro, but you wasn't really watching Attitude.
No offense.
I said, wait, you remembered that?
No, of course you have to remember that one. That's what I'm trying to tell you.
You remember that. Don't cap. You remember that.
Only thing I remember is everyone misses the shit.
And I'll tell you something. That's what a lot of these youngers, they look at that second.
I'm sorry, but I feel like a waste right now. Help me out.
They shoved Vince's face in Big Show's ass.
I get that, but listen. All I'm saying is, Lapshare, for me, they call me VHS for a reason. I can't, you have to go back and watch the old DX.
No.
Bro, that shit is entertaining.
I've gone back and watched. It's just that.
Forget the blackface stuff. Don't watch the blackface stuff.
I know about that blackface stuff. But 06 DX was my first introduction to DX. I never knew about DX before that, innit? So when I first saw Triple H and Michaels together, I was like, yo, that's mad. And then when I went and did my research, I was like, oh, snap, these lot were together.
Yeah.
And then, oh, there was more people in DX. That's when I was like, okay.
2006 will still be the best for you because you've seen it live.
That was my first
introduction. You're not reliving it sort of thing.
Yeah.
It makes sense for age profile and everything. Like, but yeah, that's ultimately why everyone laughed because 2006, judging from everything that's happened before with DX, 2006 wasn't DX.
Even for them, they said that was like, it was just like old men coming back to, just have a bit of fun, innit?
No, of course.
Michaels had to.
I appreciate it for what it was, but for me, it was like, I mean...
Okay, it's come back to me. The spiritual stuff was sick. I can't lie, that was sick. Those eagles in there, innit?
See the way man just caught, please. Man said, wait, you remember that? Now it's like... The way they used to dominate the spirit squad, and even Umaga, they held it down, that DX.
I'm sorry, but do you know, bro, let's be honest here.
You have to apologize to
I want to put that story. Everyone here has had a moment where they've actually had to deep what has been said. Do you get what I mean? Come on, man. Don't do this to me, man. Help me out, man. Hey, yo. I apologize, man. I didn't mean to do that. Yeah, Evolution. Are we done with Evolution talk? Everyone can agree here.
But really, in truth, like I said, I personally think Evolution are top three factions of all time.
Absolutely.
Okay, that's it then.
Because, like I said, they've you've got two big dons, like Flair and Triple H, that just made Batista and Orton become the stars that they are. What would have happened if Mark Jindrak came through?
Imagine.
You see where I'm coming from?
Oh, what's going on, people? It's your boy, Big Wavy Roy Johnson, and you're listening to Wrestling's.
It
Like,
no,
they were
gonna. Orton and Jindrak were friends.
They got rid of Jindrak because they kept messing around.
Yeah, yeah.
But they had already kind of started inducting him. Yeah, and I think they were gonna ditch Batista because he was injured. Batista's
injury prone a lot back then.
Man. I don't know how that would have worked. Not to say Mark Jindrak is bad, but I don't know. See,
Mark Jindrak as a character, I'm sorry, big man, you wasn't that great.
Yeah, like, he was good in ring.
Rene Dupree was better.
Rene Dupree was much better. Rene Dupree had much.
Rene Dupree had a lot of potential. Had a lot of potential to become a very good mid card star. In the Continental Championships, United States Championships, no further though.
I remember them thingy WrestleMania 20. WrestleMania 20 was such an important thingy. WrestleMania
wasn't the best WrestleMania, but one of the best. One of the most important
WrestleManias of all time.
What was on WrestleMania 20 card again?
Undertaker versus Kane,
Guerrero versus Angle. You had the ladder matches as well.
One of the best.
I remember WrestleMania 20. Guys,
yeah,
basically, from today onwards, if you guys got any topics you'd like us to discuss, it can be TNA, it could be Ring of Honor. We just have to do our research on it, basically. And ECW, was it actually that good? Mandem, let us know these like, subjects that you want to discuss, man. So if you guys got any subject for next week, you want to give us a teaser? Anyone want to bring up something for next week? I was going to say X Division.
Oh, yeah. We go and talk about that.
That was definitely good.
But that was one of the best things.
No, speak of man.
That one of the best things. I can't lie. Yeah.
X Division next week. I need to do a bit of a mad thing.
All we could say was the X Division better than the Cruiserweight Division. That could be an argument.
It was.
Cruiserweight Division in where?
In what? WWE? It was.
WCW?
In WWE?
Yeah.
It's debatable.
Okay, do you know, man? Let's get up for next week.
I'm sorry. So guys, Samoa Joe. No, I'm sorry. Samoa Joe's a 300 pounder. You put him in X Division. X Division
was no limits. From the beginning, they've always had a few.
So what?
They even had this one guy called Mr. X. I can't remember who he was. Mr. X, that's flipping PCO.
Yeah, I remember.
He had the mask with the X on it. He was a big guy.
I remember Mr. X.
So it was no limit. So for me, I felt like the X Division had more memorable moments than WWE's Cruiserweight Division did.
Can we please?
Well, we'll talk about it next week. Yeah, we'll talk about it next week.
I feel like with me, X Division, I'm going to say shit then after. I'm going to look back in all that. Yeah. I actually can watch a few more matches on X Division. I only remember like one key match in there.
Triple Threat.
Yeah.
Before we even cut off, I want to quickly ask you. You said your top three factions. What are your top three factions?
Oh, my top three factions.
Yeah. I feel like there's going to be one in there.
Ministry.
Of course. Ministry's definitely going to be there.
Ministry, Evolution. The last one.
We've got a few questions.
Yeah, we do.
Man, the last one is a tough one. On a general consensus, the Four Horsemen. That's like a general, like
yeah, it's a general, yeah,
a general
yeah.
thing. But oh man, I can't think of the last faction right now. I can't.
What about you, Max?
Evolution, DX, and I'm half tempted to probably say the Shield.
And yeah, I'll put the Shield. No, I don't know.
That's my top three.
Go on.
No particular order. I need to think about that. But DX Evolution.
Can we also mention if the Shield is overrated? I feel like they're just. I don't know.
All three members have been world champions. All three members have been PWI top 500, number one in top 500. I don't think there's an argument there for.
I know.
They won every title in WWE. Dean Ambrose, John Moxley in this last year, I think is a bit questionable. But I think he was very hot after leaving WWE. His first 6 months in AEW was good. These past six probably been a bit funny. Rocky. But apparently where they do the judging of the
similar to like a school year. Like
yeah, they yeah. Cut so off, they cut right? it off oh. after a certain period. So. They have definitely haven't considered this last 6 months when they probably put him as number one. But yeah, I don't think the Shield have. Yeah, they done their thing.
Okay.
What about you?
It's tight, man. Obviously, I had to look back and actually do some research quickly. In terms of factions, I think the first one I'll probably put into my thing was, and I say DX. DX was sick. This is a weird one because I don't know where I stand in this sort of stuff, but I was gonna say the Million Dollar Corporation, only because of like Ted DiBiase alone. Ted DiBiase was a very enjoyable character.
And you know what?
He used to maneuver around. I like the way he used to like maneuver around people, and I like that at the end of every single match, he had something to like, you know.
You know what it is? What one thing you underestimate about the Million Dollar Corporation is the depth of superstars Tebdi actually recruited. Yeah. It is a very long list.
It is.
Because of the money. Money.
It's the money. Last one, I probably have to say, this is weird, but Corporation were quite enjoyable to watch. They weren't really a faction, were they?
Sorry.
What do you mean?
We're talking WWE factions.
If you're talking professional wrestling, then there is quite a few factions.
I was going to put NWO in there, but I feel like, let's be honest here, man. You watch a few NWO matches and it just becomes bare messy.
NWO at the beginning.
If we were talking top five, I would have said NWO.
But I'm talking NWO at the beginning. I can't lie. Watch NWO right now. Yeah. Go home and watch NWO tonight and you'll see how messy some of the matches were.
I would put NWO in mine, but not because of any of their matches, because really and truly, NWO was it's a shit faction, but in terms of iconic and what they've done in terms of what they've for wrestling, even just the look alone.
The look alone, the mainstream. Anyone on the road can wear an NWO. I don't even think they'll even know it's wrestling.
You have to have on your t-shirt collection now. Yeah. Okay, I agree on that.
I actually need that.
But I think the corporation back in the day, they used to run things, man. Vince McMahon really, Vince McMahon became the real heel then. Like, that's when Vince McMahon became.
Yeah, that corporate faction was
sick. Gerald Briscoe. Who else was there?
Triple H
and DX. The Rock was part of it at one point.
Yeah, they did. Then after that, they done the corporate ministry. Unstoppable.
That was a shit faction. That was a shit faction.
Is that another day's topic?
Well, you might hear me start shouting.
That was a shit faction.
Yeah. Cool. I can't lie, you can't say that. You cannot say that. You cannot say that.
For me, the minute... they were weird, man. I'm so sorry.
They were too powerful. That's what it was.
It was weird.
They were too powerful.
It was just like... People that shouldn't... Fam, it was just weird. People just got lost in the shuffle within that faction. It was just mad
and
weird.
That's the same with NWO, bro.
Oh, yeah.
Mm. People got lost... Bro, have you watched...
Fam, for me, that? NWO...
Have you saw that?
Fam, it's one of the worst people I've ever seen in my life.
Referee's pretty. He didn't want a pin. Bro, is this WWE thing career mode? What the hell?
I mean, it's jokes. Because looking at that, it's like, okay, cool, this is an NWO pay-per-view. But really and truly, it's like... They wanted to kind of sell NWO as its own show, but really and truly, it wouldn't have made sense.
No, it wouldn't have made
sense.
You know
what I'm
saying? When they're gonna fight each other?
You know what I'm saying? Managers gonna see each other, start seeing each other.
We're underground first.
For me, I'll say Evolution, DX,
Mystery.
Probably Men on a Mission. I'm trying shit. What the hell is
that? It's not for his generation. I say, you see, you're mentioning the guys are not in his thing.
This was tag team. This
was tag
team. I'll probably say NWO, yeah. Yeah, I'll say NWO.
So who's the three?
Evolution, DX, and NWO.
Mine is defo NWO. Even though they were a bit messy, like, they have so many people in that list. So I'm just going to say Hogan, Hall, Nash. NWO.
Oh, that NWO.
That NWO.
Oh, then we're talking.
Came to WWE, I remember that one.
They come on a bully thing. They come interrogate everyone.
So I like that NWO. So I'll put them as one of my top factions. Obviously, DX. When I did my research a bit more and when I saw X-Pac, Billy Gunn, all of that was involved.
And China. You see China?
And China. She was even Intercontinental Champion
China was
as well.
The first Instagram baddie, I'm sorry. That neon drop that she wore, was it Royal Rumble?
I remember it to this day.
It's an iconic moment.
I won't lie to you.
Triple H.
I know, when I was younger.
It was ladder match. Yeah.
I can't lie, I'm going to say something bad. Okay, I'm going to stop. You know what it was?
Put the mic here.
Okay. Please let this be you. Please let this be PG. Basically.
It doesn't have to be PG, it just has to be PC.
PC.
Politically correct.
You know what it was? When I was younger, I was kind of shook of China still.
Yeah, because
China. What's wrong with that?
Like,
oh no!
Oh no! This is what I mean. I'll believe it.
Don't cut nothing out, but just beep.
I'll believe it.
Hey, but what was I saying? So she was the first Instagram baddie, man, and with that neon drop, and everyone obviously followed suit after. I just want to put that out there.
What's your third one?
League of Nations.
I was about to say, really?
League of Nations, what, with...
Stop it.
No, I'm joking. My third faction, I actually don't know, you know. I was going to say Team Extreme, Hardy Boys, Matt Hardy, Jeff and Leo. When I was young, I actually enjoyed them a lot. And, you know, I didn't like it when they broke up, but, you know, politics.
Has Stonko actually been a part of a faction? He was part of...
Two-Man Power Trip.
Yeah, he was part of the Paul Heyman faction time ago in WCW.
Or the Alliance.
Yeah. Deadly Alliance.
And randomly, I found on, before you go to Ask Wrestling, I saw this post on Instagram. Undertaker actually fought Sting.
What?
Where?
In like, let me find a picture.
Maybe if it was back in the 90s.
Back in the day. Yeah. Back in the day. Yeah, and yeah, bro, yeah. Like, it's one of these black...
Taker was in WCW back in the day.
He was in WCW, yeah.
Same time,
so he wasn't Taker.
He was
Mark Calloway.
He was something else. I forgot the name.
Something mad like that.
But he wasn't. Wait, let me find that picture, fam.
I should even know the name.
I should have screenshotted it, fam.
So technically, we've had Undertaker versus Sting.
I think it's. Hopefully, he's not in this picture.
That's Mark Calloway versus Stephen Brook.
Versus the Surfer.
Not the Undertaker I know. Not this thing that I know. It's not that.
Yeah, look. Undertaker wrestled in WCW.
Yeah, I knew. I know that. Man, I know of that. But it wasn't the Undertaker or.
Look. That's when Undertaker was being managed by Paul Heyman. It's actually a real match.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah,
I said Undertaker was a Paul Heyman.
That happened back in the '80s because they were both in WCW.
Mark Callis.
But it's just not the Undertaker.
Imagine before Undertaker retired, he became a boy. Imagine, like, back that time ago, he actually became a Paul Heyman guy.
Taker was a Paul Heyman guy. You lot should know this. It was very brief. Taker became heel. I think it was around 2005.
Became a Paul Heyman guy?
Became a Paul Heyman guy.
Where? Do you remember this?
Taker was heel.
Do you remember this?
As the dead man, it was very short.
He's number one of the Undertaker fan club. What do you expect?
Do your research.
It wasn't like a controlling thing like that, but he did send the Undertaker out to do a lot of his biddings and batter John Cena at a lot of his biddings.
Okay, you need to give me some.
I couldn't even show you. You lot can look. Yeah. And people were booing the Undertaker.
Heyman sent Undertaker out. You know.
I need to see that, fam.
Oh yeah.
You'll hit us.
Probably right. About to get into Ask Rest Things, where we get you guys to ask us some questions. First off, we've got our guy Alex McCarthy from TalkSport. Big up, Alex.
Jeez.
He asks, how many members should the Hurt Business have and why is it everyone?
It's a controversial one.
I think for the size, they're good. That's four of them now, isn't it? I think so size-wise, that's good. I wouldn't mind seeing MVP... slide out of being like an active competitor and just being a manager. I was saying the other day that I would like to see a woman join them. Zelina Vega would be a brilliant choice, but obviously she's already in something. And if we're talking like, say, a black woman, I would like Bianca Belair, but she's involved with Street Profits. So
Ember Moon. No.
Who?
Nia Jax.
Bailey.
No.
Sasha Banks.
Naomi.
Yeah.
Naomi. I don't think Naomi fits the attitude.
I could see it. We keep on cutting. I'm so sorry, bro.
I thought there's a gram set of yours. So with all everything that's going on right now, I feel like this is the best time for us to like kind of shed light on, you know, not shed light, but kind of like give Naomi the actual, do you know what I mean? Because if WWE not going to do nothing of her, MVP might as well just take her and just make her into a star.
And that's where I can say, Naomi, you can become a star. I think if she goes into that Hurt Business and becomes a bad bitch, game over. Like, I don't give a fuck. I know Naomi's got that attitude.
I think it would be sick, fam. And look, who actually would have thought that Bailey would have been a heel? That's true. No one.
That is.
And now I enjoy it.
And she's probably one of the best heels in the company.
Oh, she is.
Exactly.
She is.
Exactly.
There's potential there. Obviously, I'm thinking like she's not on Raw right now and stuff like that. Obviously, there's a draft coming. It could happen. What I was thinking is someone like Vanessa Bourne, which they've rumored to bring up from NXT. Ooh. Now, Vanessa Bourne has shown on NXT a lot of like sassy kind of behavior, a lot of attitude. And for me, it's better they kind of debut her in something that's doing well, something that's pretty high profile, rather than they just give her matches against jobbers or throw her into just nothingness on Raw. Like, she can be that woman that, I'm not saying that she has to become Raw Women's Champion, she can pretty much be like a valet or something for them at first or something, but I think it's worth putting someone that already has that kind of good attitude, and she's pretty much a clean slate. Naomi is, will be shocking because we know Naomi as a more fun loving character, but Vanessa Bourne is pretty much a clean slate. Ain't much history on her.
But I'm sorry. But it's not going to take much work for her to be like put over on us. Because obviously, if you're going to see this, obviously, we already know Naomi. We already know what she's about. We don't really know what she's in the ring. Like, if she turns heel today, it's going to be more of a shock rather than her them just bringing this new person in and they're like, oh, cool. Let's build this girl all up from the beginning. Let her fight Shayna Baszler. Let her cheat against Shayna Baszler. And after them, we're like, oh, okay, cool.
Let her batter Shayna Baszler. On some bad, that's what I'm trying to tell you. Like,
ain't nobody battering Shayna Baszler. Only best like a batter Shayna Baszler is a Shayna Baszler.
Like, okay, did you guys like Naomi when she was part of Team Bad?
Yeah,
you thought she was good.
I thought she was alright,
but she wasn't the.
Even though Sasha was the main glue to it.
What do you think?
I preferred it.
To be honest, I don't remember it.
I wasn't watching.
You know why? Because like I said, that's when the Women's Revolution was just beginning.
Yeah, I think she was decent. Sasha did obviously a lot of the heavy lifting for them, but that's why I call back to that is because that's when we've seen her on screen as a heel, and it didn't really move me. She's done okay, she's done good, but again, she wasn't the front figure.
This is the problem here, which I've been trying to understand, when everyone's saying give Naomi a push, does she deserve that push? Because now, this is what I'm trying to say, her as a baby face. Am I that invested in her? Me personally, I'm not.
She'll get a short term something.
It's
like, obviously,
I'm trying to tell, it's not that.
Sasha Banks is off TV now because she got beaten up by Bayley. Naomi was the last person to pin Bayley a couple of weeks ago. So I think Clash of Champions is going to be Bayley versus Naomi. They might have a little two month thing. Naomi will lose. That's her push.
Not to say it's the perfect time, but I think this is time where we can start developing that whole story, which leads to MVP saying, come over to my side, I'll make you a star. These men don't respect you here, I'll take you to the underground. You can beat up all these chicks. Come back to the big show.
Dominate. I feel like with Naomi, like I said, I don't think she's done enough. She needs to start again. Not start again, but just go back to the go somewhere like Raw. He said Raw and build that. So build this off. We know what you've got. We know as. So, Pop, we know.
Bro, I don't think I agree, man.
Now, being a heel. Let's pause this, yeah? There's two ways you can go about in WWE, and I feel like being a heel and being put over as a heel is winning. Like, if you do that, I feel like it's much easier for us to like you. Do you know what I mean? Like you, but some people might hate you, but more time you're going to be liked. Do you know what I mean? But when you're this goody baby face all the time, you get overlooked. Do you know what I mean?
And that's what Naomi's
become. Unless you're with the wrong. Let me go back myself. You can be a heel, yeah, and still be overlooked. But that's around how you've been positioned, around people that you've been positioned around with. But I feel like right now, the Hurt Business are hot. If Naomi gets put with the Hurt Business,
it'll boost
it up. Do you know what I mean?
But same way that her as a face, if they just put her in good programs, she'll get a boost as well.
No. Don't get me confused here. Regardless or not, Naomi, when Naomi comes on the TV screen, we're watching that. Every man's watching that, and that's no thing.
Okay, but what I'm saying is this.
I'm not saying that if she's not a heel, she's not gonna blow. Like, regardless or not, she's doing her bit. You know what I mean? I'm saying that with the heel thing, with her being a part of her business, will make things sick. Do you know what I mean?
Feel like the colourful.
Do you have a point? No, you don't have a point.
Jumpy,
I get
jumpy,
it, but I don't know if I agree.
I don't agree. So, like, this jumpy, glowy.
I think they botched it. I think we spoke about when we done our prediction show how they had Naomi at the top. They gave her a women's championship. They messed it up. She got injured along the way, but they had a chance to kind of shoot her into that superstardom, kind of give her more opportunity than they did.
She went viral.
Yeah.
I can't think of any other woman that have dominated the TO in terms of like non-wrestling fans looking at it. It's like, rah, this, like, look at the family. There's black girls looking at this girl saying, rah, this woman looks like me. She's got her afro out. She's out here just being herself, you know what I'm saying? Mm. If you're telling me like that alone, and come on, in ring, she's doing it, you know what I'm saying? We don't even have to discuss it in ring. Mm. If you're telling me from that moment alone that this is someone we can't make as a star, then fam, I don't know for this product, because WWE live off this kind of stuff, you get what I'm saying? They live off, most of the time, someone going viral, or the fans being the ones in control and saying that, listen, this is the person we want to see being pushed. Look at what happened to Kofi Kingston. That's what happened with him. Look at Daniel Bryan. This is what we've seen with him. This is nothing new. So the fact that it's for a black woman, it's not going to happen. For me, it's kind of like, fam, this company's rubbed. I'm not going to lie to you. This company's rubbed.
Bro, 100% get where Derek's coming from. I stand with that. But what I'm saying in this question here, the question was, the question was,
how many members?
How many people should join Thingy, the Hurt Business? And Naomi. Naomi's a perfect person.
Just one female.
One female. Yeah. Just make it, yeah.
It works.
One female.
And if Naomi does it, then I'll
okay.
say yes.
Okay, what female would you add?
What film would that female would that add? Yeah. I wasn't even thinking of females. I mean, besides Bianca Belair, I can't really think of anyone that
I don't think Bianca Belair needs to join.
No, she doesn't.
I don't think it, for me, it wouldn't make sense.
But for me, I'm thinking more in the scope of, okay, cool, we've got this team here. We'd want them to, like, for me, the way I look at them, I would want them to be a team that dominates every division. They've got someone that's viable for the heavyweight title, someone that's viable for the US title, and then viable for a tag team title. So for me, that's the only way I look at it. Women's title, I don't know.
So ultimately, following what you're saying, Bobby Lashley, world title, Cedric Alexander, US title, Shelton Benjamin would probably need a tag team.
Tag team partner.
Who would that be?
Him and MVP.
Who's going to hold Intercontinental then?
No, that's on SmackDown.
Alright, so
Lashley as world champion, Cedric Alexander as US champion, and then maybe MVP and Shelton, or even someone else.
If we were to discount MVP,
as
make him as a manager,
MVP really and truthfully doesn't need to be a champion.
Shelton, as well as him being a thingy.
So who would you bring in as their mid card guy then?
Yeah,
they're US champion
because they need a mid carder. This is a new evolution.
So what you said, main event is what?
Bobby Lashley.
You said who else is after?
I said Cedric Alexander as US champion.
Change that to Shelton.
No.
Either show Intercontinental or US.
I would agree with you, but if we've seen the run that they've put Shelton on now, they've made him look like a towel boy where he's just chasing for the 24/7 title. For me personally, I feel like they need to bin that title. I'm sick and tired of it. Title pisses me off.
Fam,
I cannot stand it. It looks like a fucking quality street.
You know what?
I hate this.
I was so vocal online when I saw that. And then someone was like to me, well, you don't want something they're treating like that to look like the world title, do you? And I said, fair enough.
I get that.
If it's going to be a joke, it has to look like
a joke.
I just don't want wrestlers I care about chasing after something that's a joke. Really and truly, it's not like Shelton Benjamin's on his last legs. He can still go if he wanted to. You know what I'm saying? He can still put on a good 20-30 minute match.
Did the Hardcore Championship look like a joke then?
No, I'm not gonna lie.
We had amazing moments. I can't remember any moments.
The comparison between the Hardcore and
title, the aesthetic look of the title has
nothing to do with how well run that division kind of was.
The Hardcore division was magnificent. Bro. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Magnificent. But this 24/7 thing is just.
Okay. Fam, even had like main eventers coming down to come and win. Like, fam, I remember when Undertaker versus RVD. Yeah, that's one of my favorite hardcore title matches.
Taker was
hardcore.
You know what I'm saying? Champion.
I can't imagine Brock Lesnar.
The
belt in that division wasn't the point. It was the hardcore division and what they could do. The belt was just a byproduct.
Hardcore, Crash Holly's coming in with a 2x4 and it's slapping your head straight away. Ding, ding, ding. Oh my God, Crash Holly.
And as soon as the match is done, someone else is coming in, you know what I'm saying?
Someone like Test. Gonna kick your head off out of nowhere. You're like, shit.
They had fun moments, but at the same time, there was moments where it was like, rah, this is what this division means. Whereas with 24/7 title, I don't know what is going on.
It's just R-Truth. glorification.
Fam, it's just his trophy. Like listen, we appreciate what you've done for this company. Yeah. We know you can still go, but here's just something light for you to just.
37 time champion or something.
39.
It's
ridiculous. 4-7.
Forget this.
And next question, please. And these times he hasn't been WWE champion. That's what pisses me off the most. He should have beat John Cena.
That is a robbery.
He should have beat John Cena. I'm saying this now.
R-Truth was not champion is a fucking robbery. And yeah, Vince, you'll never be forgiven for
that. You know what? This is actually a fun fact of R-Truth. He was the first black NWA world champion.
Yeah,
facts.
You know how mad that is?
Yeah.
His when he was champion in TNA, bro, I said, he was serious, bro. From the Truth killings.
They're going to talk about R-Truth a lot when he's gone.
Bro. Oh, yeah.
Facts.
He's going to be in the Hall of Fame. Like,
that question is hilarious.
Next question. Big up Chris DeCapo. Shout out to Battle the Roof. He asks, Chris DeCapo asks Black.
No, Mr. I told him anyway, there's a very hot place for him. For him to get to that
very, very hot place. He says, ask Mr. S. Blacks to recommend us 5 of Viscera's best matches.
Talk a shit, man. I'm with you.
Can you recommend 5 matches?
I'm with you.
If you want to watch a Viscera match, him against Bobby, him against Chris, him against Cena, him against Albert, you know what, the handicap match with Taker versus Gangrel and Viscera, that was a good one. I like that too.
Are you naming his best matches or are you naming
I think of films that he enjoyed. I'm with you on this one, I can't lie,
big up Chris DeCapo, big up Battle on the Roof.
I told you, Chris.
We got 2 questions from Gareth from RHW. Big up Gareth, my guy. Gareth never misses. Make sure you guys follow him. That's my guy. He asked for the first question, what are your hopes for Rey and Dominic Mysterio? A tag team, a match at WrestleMania, mentorship as Dominic continues his career.
It's a mentorship.
I don't want him to turn on his dad either.
The turn has to come.
Dominic has to turn on his son.
I am Dominic Guerrero. That's what he has to say. Book that now.
I can't lie, I feel like I can't see that yet. That's the reason I said no, and I don't want it to happen.
I can see it coming. Do you know what I can really see with all this angle right now? Seth recruits Dominic and just face the family away, and it's Dominic, Murphy, and Seth. Seth's like, these are my disciples. We're coming.
To be fair, Seth needs the disciples because all his disciples are even getting kicked out.
The bodyguards, I'm gone.
No, but I like this Monday Night Messiah thing.
I love it.
You know what? They're winding him down. Obviously, he's going to go on paternity leave very soon. Yeah, so they're winding him down how to take him off TV. She's due in December. So without doubt, obviously with COVID as well, they're probably going to stop him from traveling. She announced it in March, April-ish.
April, yeah.
I think she was about 2 months pregnant when she announced it.
After WrestleMania.
So,
22 weeks, right?
After Money in the Bank.
What, his paternity leave?
Yeah.
This is WWE. He's an independent contractor.
When you said independent, so these men are all freelancers, basically.
They're basically
shagging people, fam. You're freelance, but you can't go to any promotion.
Well, there's contracts.
Because it's an exclusive contract.
So
that's an exclusive independent.
That's what that makes sense.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. There's contracts put in place. So if you're a freelancer, you know what I mean?
That contract doesn't make sense, fam.
It doesn't, but it's like WWE, they're trying to avoid having to pay healthcare for their wrestlers, etc. So,
but aren't they paying that?
Crazy, fam.
I think the wrestlers have to pay for everything. That's why they're independent contract.
There's something around that because, like, when they get injured, that's why they add the time back onto their contract because they haven't actually fulfilled the contract that they were paid for.
That's why when Rey Mysterio first left, he didn't leave until like maybe like a year after because they put time on because of his injury. So I think they put like an extra year on. That same thing that happened with Neville as well. He was injured, so they put more time on. And the same thing happened with FTR as well. Yeah. They put more time on the contract.
But obviously,
with Neville, they just, fuck it, this guy's not coming back. He's sitting out.
I was seeing something on the TL about people complaining about wrestlers making their own money. The Twitch thing. Yeah. Okay.
Just on Dominic Mysterio, Rey Mysterio again. I think, the mentorship thing that everyone's saying, it has to run, but the story would not be complete without the turn. So whether that turn is 3, 4, 5 years down the line, the student has to betray his master, like
at all times.
Okay, if you frame it like that, like obviously you have the mentorship thing, and after as time goes on, he's like, yo, don't touch, you can't mentor me no more. I've grown rings, then yeah, it makes sense, but. Yeah. But I can't see it now, man.
Not in the next
12 months. But I
that's an emotional storyline, you know.
Yeah.
People will be crying from watching that, bro. Because once they include Eddie in that storyline, that's what's gonna hit all of us, bro. I think we'll probably shed a tear that day. I can't lie. I'm not Dominic Mysterio. I'm Dominic Guerrero. You see the promo here? The Guerrero will be echoed. Guerrero, 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 Guerrero.
Can imagine. Yeah.
After they do that, they'll do some next cut here where they show Dominic doing the 5-star Fox match. You got me for a while.
He might actually just wear Eddie Guerrero's old shirt. I'm your pappy.
That's mad. They might have to. I can't lie. They might have to bring Vicky Guerrero back for this, man. On a quick thing, fam.
Last question from Gareth again. He asks thoughts on Anthony Ogogo in AEW. What are the hopes for him? Also, which UK song would you give him for his wrestling theme song? His suggestion is "Art of War" by Abracadabra. That is a sick song.
Wait, who's Anthony Ogogo?
The boxer.
Has he even debuted yet?
No, he's going through the developmental thing.
AEW.
Yeah, he was one of the earlier signings.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
I'm happy he's going through developmental.
Yeah.
It would be interesting to see.
What was the first thing he asked?
What are your hopes for him? What's the hopes for him?
I don't know. I just wanted to go out there and kill it because obviously he's from England.
From the UK,
he's British. We got it poppy in it. So I want him to go out there and smash it.
And he's Nigerian as well. So
exactly, big up, man. So I want him to go out there and smash it. I want him to have his finisher move to be a knockout.
I
think for theme song, I think he should put up with one UK producer, and just make something sick. JO is around the corner, so JO hit him up, and hopefully you guys can make some PRS money or something like that.
I'd like to see him come up to like On Deck or something, like Abracadabra On Deck. Fam, that's my tune, fam. That's my tune, Jiggy Jiggy On Deck. That's a banger, fam.
A UK producer on live television, wrestling, AEW, that would be big.
Yeah, if they don't get him a UK producer to do his song, or they get one of these generic... If I hear him come out to music like that, I'm going to be fuming. Anthony, I don't know if you're going to see this, yeah? Anthony, if you're seeing this, make sure. Anthony, if you're seeing this video, make sure you get a UK producer. I don't know who you have to chat to. Don't know if it's Cody or Tony Khan. Make sure they do you right by your theme music. I don't want to hear no yege generic rock music, fam.
So I think we've got one song we got in mind for you. Play it.
Fam, I'm walking out. Fam, if I hear Anthony Ogogo come out to one dead rock shoot, I promise you I'm not watching AEW again. Fam.
And where is John Moss? What's your key?
I don't know.
It's generic.
I'm not gonna lie. You seen AEW, I feel like there's only four people's theme songs that you know. There's Proud and Powerful, because that's done by what's his name?
Pusha T?
No, not Pusha T. What's this guy's name? Bodega Bams. It's done by Bodega Bams. I know Jericho because he's got the best theme song. I know Cody's theme song is good. And I know Best Friends. Other than that, I don't know. And I know MJF.
Jericho's theme song.
Yeah.
Go on.
Oh, there's this shit, man. They changed theirs, yeah.
No, Jericho's theme tune is the coldest.
But other than that, I don't know anybody's theme song.
This is it.
It's a drummer theme.
That sounds like something you hear on like Sunday Night Heat. Play. Okay, guys, welcome back to Sunday Night.
We've got our main event right now.
On tonight's show, we got Dino Brown versus Viscera.
I actually remember the Heat theme song
was sick.
The Heat theme song was hard.
It was hard.
I remember we had that whole mix of like rock and rap.
Afterburn's one was quite sick as well.
Afterburn.
Hopefully copyright don't come out and flop us, fam.
But I used to love watching Velocity, man, every Sunday. I would love it for a quick hour. No, because they would include matches as well. That's when I watched the Finley and Benoit match. I just fell in love with that kind of wrestling. Oh, man. Sorry.
Let me find this Afterburn.
Jeez. Sounds like something you hear in SmackDown. Here Comes the Pain when you're having a match backstage.
But yeah, man. Obviously, man, send us your questions for next week. Obviously, next week we've also discussed that we're going to talk about the X Division, right?
Was it that good?
And also try and touch. We're going to try and do two topics.
Let's try to do the. Was it that good? Let's try to do two.
Okay.
Yeah, let's try to do two.
I've got you one time though. I'm going to do Undertaker's streak. I've got bare stuff to pick about that. Undertaker's streak was. I'm going to say it quick before we go here.
I can't even lie. I cannot lie.
I'm going to be dead real with you. Come on. Undertaker's streak here was not actually that good.
Wow.
I don't even like it when you think like that,
bro.
The Undertaker's WrestleMania streak.
Bro, look at the people he's going up against in his early career, fam, and you see the reason why I said that.
That's correct. In my opinion, the Undertaker streak is the apart from his character is like the greatest thing about it. That is his championship. Because if we talk about titles, what did he really do?
No.
Stop again.
Titles.
Taker has basically been a Grand Slam champion.
And I'm not denying that, but in terms of iconic things he was involved in as champion and stuff like that, it's not as many if you compare it to his counterparts. He's not that iconic as a champion.
Okay, compare it to the HHs and
yes, oh yeah, as HHs
and the Rock. Sorry, when I get annoyed, I start going in. And the Austins, all right.
The streak is the best thing he's done. That is.
I'm sorry.
Before we go, it's the best thing. It's the greatest thing.
Okay, don't get me wrong. The streak is sick, yeah. But I'm saying, bro, if you watch the match, like, because I was watching, last month in August, yeah, I was watching all the streak matches. I think all on YouTube, I was watching all after the other. I was like, fam, these matches are boring, fam.
Are you crazy?
I have no answer. My only thing is I'll say is the streak became good when it was officially known as the streak.
That's my problem.
Yeah. When Taker done the 10 thing.
Yeah.
That's when the match quality went up.
But match with Jake the Snake was not shit. His match with Jimmy Flash, it was not shit.
Bro, come on, don't be like this, man. Listen. Bro, you know I like WrestleMania 8. Bro, you know I like WrestleMania 8, right?
Giant Gonzalez.
Bro, you know I like
Gonzalez match was void, didn't it? That was void.
Bro, listen, let me be honest. You know I like WrestleMania 8, right? You know I like WrestleMania 8. Bro, yes, be honest here. The match quality in these matches were not the one that as good, bro. But yeah, this is for another time, man. Guys.
Hey, Max, you might have to come back for the street call.
Just for that, yeah, I'm watching every single match.
Bro, watch it tonight. You'll see what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
and let me know what you think of every single match.
You know what? We'll get you lot involved as well.
Yeah.
Send us your videos, okay? We'll make a compilation video as this as well. Send us your videos. Let us know if you think the streak was that good or not.
Was it actually that good?
Unbelievable.
Guys, have we got guys, a title screen? Have we got a title screen for Was It Really That Good?
I'm going to make one.
I have to make one.
Trust me. Hey, Laps, you working tonight? I'm going to have to get you to make one still.
Avengers Assemble!
Trust me. Guys, man, it's been a sick podcast. I've enjoyed coming back here. Because of these COVID, the situation we're in right now, we couldn't be on Zoom and stuff, but we couldn't be in the studio and stuff, but I'm honestly so happy to be back here with you guys, man. I wish you guys... Miss talking about wrestling. I feel like it's been a very fluid podcast as well. Obviously, the Zoom sometimes. Some people's internet cutting off. Some people messaging the group chat saying, yo, do the thing about me.
Hey, this nigga's a snitch, fam. What the fuck's wrong with
this nigga? Yo, the last time we got a podcast here, fam, man was frozen like this.
Hey, this nigga's a snitch.
I was like, yo, Derek, what do you think? He's like, it's.
Hey, fuck Virgin Media.
But yeah,
this nigga's a snitch, fam.
But yeah, man, that's been sick, man. Obviously, you're trying to pick up yourself and,
Yeah, just thanks for having me, boys. I'll be back again as long as I'm welcome. WrestleManiac UK on everywhere. Daily videos on YouTube and in my Instagram. So, yeah.
He said daily. Daily, every day.
Let me tell you what, one.
As in, I'll go to bed, he's posted the video. When I wake up, he's posted the video.
On church Sunday, when the pastor's doing the offering, he posted
When I finished in gym, I've realised, he's posted another video.
When I'm about to tuck into my Eba and look at see, he's doing a video.
Trust me, it's job. It's
hard work.
It's too much. We have to
keep going. Just see, man. I think late. I think it was at 1 a.m. Bro, you were doing live with Black Wrestlers. I was like, bro, this is going to sleep. Hey, big up you, bro.
You post so much, there's times in my head I'm thinking, no, fuck it, I need to record something today. I don't know what I'm going to record. I just put the camera up, like, you know what? this is why this guy is shit. This is a fam. No, facts.
No, man, you kill it, man.
Facts,
you kill it,
man. Facts.
You kill it.
And facts. I know I keep on talking about it, but yes, I have been.
It's coming soon. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Mr. Controversial series, it's coming. It is really coming.
Yeah.
Controversial fast come like the Chronic fam. Come like Dr. Dre's album fam.
It's coming, bro.
It's coming, though.
Yeah. But yeah, man, I've been a Nafi, aka Vicious Pappy. Sam, I need you to watch that Undertaker Street next week, man. Because we need to talk about that.
I'll be honest with you, I actually know what to say. Okay, but cool. I'm going to watch it again. Okay. Just so
forget the X Division stuff. Then we'll talk about Undertaker next week. Where you going, bro?
Wait, give it.
You want?
No. Go on, do it next. Okay, cool. It's fine. Actually,
that's calm. Doughboy. Jesus, is not. This nigga's in the canteen, fam.
Laps is getting you to the whole.
This nigga's in the canteen, fam.
So he's gonna get better.
Next week, my promo will be on point. But yeah, it's the Laps. You can find me on Instagram at thelaps316, and then my graphic design Instagram, prominentpsd.
Make sure you go follow him, man.
If you want them wrestling posters as well, you know, come shout me.
When you dropping a t-shirt?
Oh man, I actually have to redo it. You know.
What? You made that?
I made it, but it was wet.
Crazy.
It was wet, so I want to redo it. I need it to be a bit bigger because it was only up here.
I've got an idea for you still, but we'll discuss off podcast, man.
Should I bleep the Eddie Guerrero stuff? You don't want to reveal that to people.
Let them know.
There's
better Eddie
Guerrero
t-shirts, just not like mine.
Talk your shit, Marco.
You know that,
man.
But yeah.
Eddie Guerrero t-shirts will be coming soon. Rest Things merch, bro.
Yeah.
Stay tuned for that. Rest Things merch.
Oh, yeah. Power Drive over Panani. The t-shirts are coming soon.
I've seen that.
The t-shirts are coming soon.
That's hard.
For you fucking virgins out there.
I'm investing.
But yeah, man. Big up everyone, man. Big up everyone that's doing their bits.
Big up Versi. You couldn't make it today.
Yeah, man.
To this day, we don't know what he looks like.
I know what he looks like.
He's a bad guy.
What do we say, mandem?
By the mandem, for the mandem. Bow! We're back, pussy.